This afternoon is homecoming weekend, and the HBU Huskies will try to celebrate with a homecoming victory over the Texas A&M Commerce Lions. Live from Straight Jesuit Crusader Stadium, it's HBU Huskies football, and we're glad you're along for the ride. Hello, everyone. Welcome into the broadcast today. I'm Lonnie King, and along with Jeff Power, we're set to bring you this one. Homecoming weekend's always neat, Jeff, and the Huskies, for the first time in school history, are celebrating homecoming with a football game, and it's kind of a nice atmosphere for the school.
Oh, absolutely. In fact, I saw a lot of tailgating going on out in the parking lot, everyone having a good time. There's really not a senior night. You can't really do that here because so many freshmen and obviously sophomores and some junior college transfers. But no doubt about it, HBU coming off their best performance of the entire season. They beat Texas College last week 49-7. They got out to that fast start. They ran the ball well behind B.J. Kelly, and Kadarius Baker was very efficient through the air. Defense had a pick six, couple of big plays with some sacks, a lot of good pressure. If they can get that kind of performance against a good Texas A&M Commerce team, look out. HBU could finish the season 4-3, which would be very impressive in their first inaugural season.
And it's something they'd love to do, as Jeff said, though. It's a tough opponent they've got to try to do it against today. But A&M Commerce has struggled a little bit in their conference play, and they've had some injuries to deal with as well.
Yeah, they have had some injuries. Tyreek Rollison's probably the best player on the team. Well, he's been out the last couple of weeks. In steps Harrison Stewart at the quarterback position. Now, he's someone who can get the job done, but they've noticed that difference. I mean, first of all, Tyreek Rollison is the kind of player that has been compared to Cam Newton, so that ought to give you an idea how good he is. So that could be a big situation right there, but no question, HBU still needs to get that pressure on the quarterback, no matter who it is, and play good strong defense. I mean, this is a Texas A&M Commerce team that is equivalent to an ACU, an Abilene Christian type of team that did not make HBU look too good earlier this season. So, bottom line is, they've got some athletes, they've got some speed. It's the biggest challenge they'll have of the season here late in the year. We'll see if they're up for it.
And it would be a nice ending to a nice developmental season for this HBU Huskies football team. We'll have all the play-by-play for you coming up straight ahead right here as you watch HBU Huskies football presented by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation on the Legacy Sports Network.
Fans, I see a Raising Cane's tailgate in your sights. And I'm not saying it's going to be easy, but you have it in you to tackle that tailgate. To devour enough fresh, never-ever-frozen chicken fingers and cane sauce to make tailgate history. Show thirst who's boss with sweet tea and lemonade. Not by the cup, but by the jug. Because this is our house. And today, you eat with the best of them. Raising Cane's, one love. Official sponsor of all things that make game day delicious.
When you have a medical emergency, think Physicians ER. You will be seen by a board-certified doctor in less than 10 minutes. With immediate results on labs, x-rays, and CAT scans. For emergency care greater than urgent care, think Physicians ER. Accidents happen anytime, any place. When you need to be seen fast, visit Physicians ER. Visit physicianser.com for a location nearest you.
Change is inevitable. Time waits for no one. And those who look only to their past are rarely ready for their future. Never underestimate our ability, because after all, we are Texans.
Straight Jesuit Crusader Stadium, the home of Straight Jesuit Crusaders, the college prep school here in the Houston area that has loaned their stadium this season to the HBU Huskies for this inaugural season. And I know HBU is grateful for that, but they're also looking forward to getting into their home field next year, Jeff. And looking at this one straight ahead of us, got to look at the numbers for both these teams.
Yeah, I don't think there's any question. Texas A&M Commerce, they can pass the football, over 2,700 yards passing. 3,421 total yards, if you include that 700 yards on the ground. But the fact that they're averaging over 300 yards through the air and they're only producing 380 total for the game ought to tell you they are a pass-first team, rush later. We'll see if maybe HBU can kind of key on that and put them in a position where they have to run the football.
And when you look at the scoring numbers, don't be too deceived. The scoring numbers for A&M Commerce have come over a 9-game span. The scoring numbers for HBU have come over a 6-game span. But it is significant, I think, that this is really one of the only other teams besides Sam Houston State and Abilene Christian that we face that has outscored their opponents. So we've got a tough task ahead of us today.
Yeah, I don't think there's any question about that, a tough task. But this is a good measuring stick for them. At 3-3 in the season, full stadium here, at least on the HBU side, I don't think there's any question about it. We are ready for kickoff. It's homecoming. Great atmosphere. First afternoon game at home all season. I think everyone here is fired up and ready to go.
Well, it's turned out to be a nice afternoon, not too warm, not as cool maybe as you'd like for it to be, a little bit overcast. The lights are already on here at the field. As we move later into the afternoon, that may come into play, but right now the overcast skies are lighting up the southwest Houston area. Saw a few raindrops on the way into the stadium, but nothing here so far, and hopefully the weather won't be a factor this afternoon.
No, the wind is not a factor, and that's probably the most important thing. And I think most of these guys will tell you that these are perfect temperatures for playing football. They have to wear a lot of gear out there, and, you know, the days of 100 degrees are way in the past now. So it's time to play some football, and I want to see what HBU's got today in front of probably their biggest crowd of the season. Homecoming, everybody wants to see a good show by the local team, and they look fired up. Just running around on the field with them out there before kickoff, they look really amped up and ready to go.
Travis Shin's got it teed up. He is ready to kick it away. The Huskies will go on defense first. Back deep for A&M Commerce to return the kick here. Vernon Johnson, a 6'1 junior out of Fort Worth, and Ronald Fields, a 6'3 junior from Sacramento, California. Fields wears a number 4. Johnson wears a number 6. It's coming down. Going to be high and short. One of the upbacks takes it. And he will take it to the left side, heads to the sideline, gets out around the 28-yard line, and that is where A&M Commerce will set up shop here on this first possession.
And some of the team leaders for the HBU Huskies, of course, Kadarius Baker, B.J. Kelly, and Darian Lazard, no question about that. And I think when you look on the other side of the field, there's no question that when your opponent is Texas A&M Commerce, the big difference is going to be at the quarterback position. Harrison Stewart is going to be making the start. We'll see what he's got under center today.
3-4 defense for the Huskies as they come to the line of scrimmage, and Commerce wants to throw it on first down. The pass is complete. Stewart completes it across the middle to Jordan Jenkins right out at midfield. A nice gain on first down, 22 yards. And they'll move the chains right off the bat.
Yeah, Stewart, he's 6'5", 245 pounds. He is a junior out of California, and they have a hurry-up offense. So here we go.
Quick pass out to the sideline. Receiver makes the catch quickly. Get that number. I believe it was Stacy Howard. No, check that. Looks like Salim Zongo, and he makes the catch. 5-yard gain. It'll bring up 2nd and 5. Just underway here at Crusader Stadium. Clock rolls down toward the 14-minute mark, and we're glad you're along with us. Stewart wants to throw on 2nd down, has a receiver. He'll make the catch and take it into the end zone. Seth Smith with the reception and the touchdown, and, wow, that did not take long.
Yeah, no question as far as the defensive back situation for HBU. Kind of burned on the play right there. Letting him get behind him was Oral Bankole, and that ends up being costly. It's a touchdown for Texas A&M Commerce, and that's not the start you want if you're a Husky fan.
3 plays, 72 yards. Did not take even 1 minute off the clock. 14:04 to go here in the first quarter. Out to attempt the extra point is Saul Martinez. And the kick is up, and it is good. And just like that, A&M Commerce strikes quickly, and they're up 7-0. Back with the kickoff. You're watching HBU Huskies football presented by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation on the Legacy Sports Network.
If I get pneumonia,
break my arm.
Need to know if my pain is something more.
I know I can trust Neighbors Emergency Center to save me.
They save my time.
They'll save me from missing the championship.
They'll save me from missing my meeting.
They'll save me from missing the chance to walk her down the aisle someday.
They save me. He saves me.
You save me.
Neighbors Emergency Center saves lives.
Neighbors Emergency Center. Care that counts. Experience that matters.
Three-play, 72-yard drive capped off by a 45-yard touchdown pass from Harrison Stewart to Seth Smith. And the Texas A&M Commerce Lions strike quickly here. And before the homecoming crowd can get into the stadium almost and find their seats, Huskies have some catching up to do.
Time to answer.
Comes down to Taylor Thompson, straight up the numbers, gets a block, pushes it to the outside across the 40, 50, into Commerce territory, and he'll be out of bounds at about the 44-yard line. Great return by the freshman from Belleville.
Well, and Taylor Thompson, I mean, he had a big game last week with the two interceptions. He returned one for a touchdown, had a fumble recovery. He was the CFPA FCS National Defensive Back of the Week. That's a big play right over here, and they needed that. They needed a little spark from their special teams, get themselves in good field position, and they're on the A&M Commerce side of the ball, or side of the field.
This is an unofficial comment, but I would have to say that's probably the best kickoff return we've seen all season by the Huskies. Kadarius Baker out there running the offense, and B.J. Kelly in the backfield with him. They're going to hand it to him, and now a reverse to Ethan Fry. Wide open spaces in front of him, a blocker downfield inside the 20 and bumped out of bounds at the 18-yard line. And a big play on the first possession and the first play offensively for HBU.
When you design a play like this, you've got to be able to get the blocking downfield. And Ethan Fry is so fast. Once he grabbed the ball, as you mentioned, Lonnie, he had open space and took advantage of it.
Right back to the line of scrimmage. Baker trying to go with a quick count, maybe to draw Commerce offside. And now hand it off straight up to gut to Kelly. Kelly plows forward down to about the 15-yard line. B.J. Kelly, the leading rusher on this team, freshman out of Waco. He's been a pleasant surprise for the Huskies this season.
Yeah, he had 111 yards rushing last week and a touchdown, and he is the go-to man on the ground. But they've had a lot of back step up last week, all four of them, in fact. As we take a look at the starting lineup here for the Huskies.
Baker and company right back to the line of scrimmage. Kenneth Bibbins split out wide to the left side. Fake the handoff. Baker's going to keep it, and he loses the football. It comes out, and Commerce picks it up, and they're going to take it the opposite direction on the run all the way in with the return. Looks like Cameron Napoleon, and he takes it in for a touchdown.
And well, I tough break right there. It's one of those plays where you're thinking, was he down? Was he not down? It doesn't matter. It's a touchdown going the other way right now for Texas A&M Commerce. But it looked like initially that maybe Baker's knee was actually down on the ground. But that's such a quick call, and you don't want to leave that in the hands of the officials. Most importantly, Baker's got to find a way to hang on to that football.
It was Pablo Vasquez on the return. So just like that, when the Huskies looked like they were ready to answer the opening touchdown drive by the Lions, turnover, and now the extra point. We've got a flag on the extra point attempt, so let's see what we've got here. No signal yet from the officials. It appears it's going to be on HBU, though. And it is offside, so it'll be declined. The extra point is good, and A&M Commerce opens up a two-touchdown lead. And, Jeff, man, that is a big momentum swing with that turnover.
There goes 14 points right there. I mean, you go from tying the game up to now giving up seven, and you're trailing 14-0. And it was a good drive. In fact, the play from Ethan Fry was a great call. Kind of had A&M Commerce back on their heels a little bit. But Baker had that seam cut through there, dropped the ball. Touchdown going the other way. It happens. I think at this point, if you're Vic Schiele, you just kind of, you know, wrestle up the troops and say, look, okay, forget about what just happened. We had a good drive going. They just made two big plays on us. Let's not lose our confidence.
Well, there's still 12 and a half minutes to go in the first quarter of play, so plenty of time. And as you said, just underway, so no reason to abandon a game plan right now.
Yeah, turnovers are just – they're hard to overcome at times, but the way you overcome it is you force some turnovers on the other side if possible. Looks like the ball was they're waiting for the ball to be teed up.
Yeah, and the back judge not in any hurry to get it over to the kicker.
Maybe they thought the game was getting out to too quick of a start. Slow things down a little bit. Let everybody sit down.
Cameron Frosch, number 96 for Texas A&M Commerce, is their punter, but he pulls the kickoff duties, and he'll get a toe into this one. It's going to come down high and short to Tanner Peavy. He signals for a fair catch and makes it at the 24-yard line, and that's where HBU will set up shop on this possession after a nice opening drive that was only marred by the fumble that was returned for the touchdown.
You know, this is an A&M Commerce team that last season was 1-9. They were 1-7 in conference play. This year they're out to a 6-3 start. And I think, you know, when HBU scheduled them, you're probably looking at a team that, okay, they're 1-9. That might be a good way to, you know, wrap up the season, bring them in for homecoming. But tell you, the Lions have played pretty good football this year.
Under a first-year coaching staff, and it's evident that they've brought in a new attitude and some good results with that. Here's a handoff to Kelly on first down, and Baker gives it up to the freshman from Waco Midway, and Kelly carries it forward across the 25 to about the 26. Give him a couple of yards on the gain. Second down and 8. Baker back to the shotgun. The Huskies, as you know if you followed us all season long, operate without a huddle. Right from the line of scrimmage, Baker goes to the snap count and then usually backs away to get the read on the defense. Now under pressure in the backfield, a flag comes in, but swarmed under and dropped for a sack back at the 15-yard line. Skadarius Baker, pressure came from both edges that time. Let's see what the flag's going to be about.
Yeah, they got a lot of pressure around the side. We're hoping for perhaps an offsides penalty, but it looks like they're marking it off against the Huskies.
Holding, and the referee said the penalty was declined, and then they stepped off the penalty. So not sure what the signal is there. It's got to be second down. The yard marker says third down. That cannot be correct, though, I don't think. Somebody on the sideline should call a timeout, but they're going to go with it. So officially it's third down, and Baker under pressure again has to unload it on the run, trying to swing it out to Craig Bell. Or check it, that's B.J. Kelly, 5, not 3. But, Jeff, I honest to goodness thought that that should be a second down play there. And now,
well, the officials signaled it like they were declining the penalty, and then they ended up walking it off. That was the difference. And when they walked it off, it should have replayed the down.
Well, nevertheless, it's fourth down, and the Huskies have to punt the ball away, and David Duncan is on for the first time this afternoon. Back at his own 2, good snap from center. Danny Garza gets him the snap, and he gets a good kick away. It's going to take a Commerce roll, though. Bounces at the 42 and bounds back to the 44, where the deep snapper himself, Danny Garza, freshman out of San Antonio, downs it. And now we've got flags back up the field.
Some key players on the defensive side of the ball here for HBU: Garrett Dolan, Terrell Brown, Cody Moncure, Taylor Thompson, Keith Ewing. Important for all these guys to step up today. In fact, Dolan and Brown each have over 50 tackles on the season. Cody Moncure is at 46. Those are the kind of guys that need to kind of regroup and get this team back on track here today, up down 14-0 already.
Well, now the officials are going to step off a penalty against HBU and take the ball to the 46-yard line in Huskies territory. And the last couple of flags that have been thrown have been costly to the Huskies. They'll start this possession in their own end of the field. And here is a pass out in the flat. It's complete by Stewart to Stacy Howard. Check it. That is Vernon Johnson who makes the catch.
Well, we just talked about Garrett Dolan and Terrell Brown. They were both in on that tackle right there, and they're both freshman linebackers. And I tell you, it's a good sign when your linebackers are leading the way in tackles. Early in the season, the defensive backs were leading the way for HBU.
Stewart wants to throw, and he's got a receiver down the sideline, but overthrows. Pretty good coverage that time by Cody Moncure. Kept the receiver from running the route I think that he wanted to, and the pass falls incomplete.
Yeah, Cody Moncure, he is your safety, 46 tackles, 32 solo, but he had good coverage downfield, stayed stride for stride with his man. That's what you want to do at the last minute, make a play for the ball.
Third down now, 7 yards to go. Ball is at the 43-yard line. Three receivers split out wide to the right side. Ball is on the left hash mark. Stewart under a little pressure. Lets it go, though, and throws downfield. Incomplete. Pretty good coverage again. That time, Jahala Norris picked up his assignment. Seth Smith. And do we have another flag down? We do. It's holding this time against Commerce.
And this one will be declined. So that will bring up 4th and 7 here for Texas A&M Commerce. It looks like they're going to punt the football. And that was important. I don't think there's any question. Houston Baptists need to force some sort of 3-and-out right here, and they did their job.
Good job defensively. I don't believe we've seen Commerce with a rushing play yet on offense. I think all of their downs have been passing downs so far.
Yeah, their stats, they certainly show that. You don't want to assume they can't run the football when they don't even try.
Frosch is in to kick the ball away. A high wobbly spiral, nose up, and it's going to take a bounce at the 17-yard line, roll sideways, and it'll be down there. And the Huskies, for the third time this afternoon, will send out their offense.
So this is a key possession here for HBU. I think right now, a chance that their defense just forced a 3-and-out, Kadarius Baker. I think HBU goes back to running the football right here, see what they can do up the middle, see if they can't force things here and get the ball, get a good drive put together.
They'll do it with a two-back set as they come to the line of scrimmage. Kadarius Baker has both Craig Bell and B.J. Kelly in the backfield with him. Two receivers out to the left side of the formation. Darian Lazard back in there this week after missing last week with strep throat. And here's a pass down the field to Kenneth Bibbins. Makes the reception, but out of bounds. Could not keep the feet inbound. Bibbins is a nice-looking receiver, and I know he has impressed the coaches this season.
Yeah, Kenneth Bibbins, 6'5", 242. He's out of Sugar Land, Texas, transferred from the University of Houston. Looks like he should play tight end. Was listed as a tight end early in the season, but they use him as a wide receiver now. He's got great hands, as you saw right there. Just couldn't quite haul that one in. Baker led him a little too far out of bounds.
Come back with the same formation on 2nd and 10, and this time they will hand it off to Kelly. Kelly turns up at the hash marks, has a lane, 40, 50. Inside Commerce territory, still on his feet, slips an arm tackle down inside the 10, and he's bumped out of bounds at the 6-yard line. First and goal for the Huskies.
You gotta love the way BJ Kelly runs the football. So determined, looked at the man who was chasing him downfield and just said, "Come on, I'm bringing you with me." You know, last week, the formation having the two back set really worked well. They ran the ball well out of that set, and they do it again right here. There's nothing like running the football to get back in the game. Don't panic. Don't change the game plan and try to pass your way back in. Run the football.
After the nice long run by Kelly, he gets a breather. Larry Day checks in, joins Craig Bell in the backfield. And they hand it off today up the middle into the end zone. Touchdown, Huskies.
On the ground once again right there. And that was impressive. All those plays right there on the ground, the key ones, that's what they needed. Back into the game, 14-6 now, extra point pending. But that was what they needed. He had a three and out on defense. Offense makes three huge plays on the ground. Touchdown, 14-7 momentarily.
And you're right back into the game. Ready for the extra point. Out of the hold of Duncan, Shin nails it. And 9:38 to go on the first quarter clock. And for the first time this afternoon, the Huskies are on the scoreboard. Our score now, Texas A&M Commerce, 14, Houston Baptist, 7. You're watching HBU Huskies football. And here again is a touchdown run by Larry Day from 6 yards away. He carried it in. Pretty good blocking up front.
Yeah, Larry Day, such an added addition in the latter part of the season here for HBU. Between B.J. Kelly, Craig Bell Jr., Larry Day, they run the ball well. It's been one of the bright spots for the team this year. They've got a really good strength in running the football. The offensive line's done a nice job, and I really like seeing that on that drive right there. We've got ourselves a game, and why not? It's homecoming.
That's what you want to see on homecoming. You want a nice crowd, which they've got. You want some excitement among the student body to see who's going to be crowned homecoming king and queen at the half, which will happen here in just a little while. And you want a competitive football game. And for the first time in school history, that's what HBU has, a football homecoming afternoon. Something a little bit special about that.
Yeah, and we talked, you know, there's not going to be a senior day when you don't really have any seniors, but this is a squad that's, you know, 4 years from now, senior day is going to be very special.
A long ceremony that day.
Yeah, exactly. I don't think, no question about it, Lonnie, that's what they needed on both sides of the ball, defense with a three and out, the offense with the nice long drive on the ground, special teams now. I was talking with several coaching staff members here at HBU, and they said that you got to watch the return men for A&M Commerce. They've got some guys back deep who can really make some things happen. And so we'll see. We'll keep an eye out for, looks like maybe Ronald Fields and Seth Smith and or Vernon Johnson and Ronald Fields right now. Vernon Johnson's back deep.
Travis Shin gets it high and short, and it comes down to Fields. He'll take it up the sideline, and pretty good return. A flag out down at the 43-yard line, and Shields got out to about the 45, 46, but let's see what this flag's about. It's going to be a hold on Commerce. That's going to benefit the Huskies and send them back, negate some of the return. Let's watch it again, see if we pick it up. Well, I think it was probably where you saw the white jersey pulling the blue jersey to the ground. That's where they got it. Oh, and now we're going to have offsetting penalties. Offsides on the Huskies.
That was kind of a late call.
I didn't see the flag down here on the Huskies end of the field.
So we'll re-kick that one. You're going to see a lot of these high end-over-end kicks today for HBU. That's kind of the game plan right now with Travis Shin, is to get it up high and get your team down the field and then make a play. Sometimes I actually think that those high kicks like that, that, you know, come in around the 20 are more effective than the deep kick, you know, that's brought in around the 5 where they've got plenty of room to run, you know.
Yeah. Saw Vic Sheely go out onto the field there to talk to Travis Shin, give him some instructions for this kickoff. So we'll see what the order is.
Travis, kick it a little further this time. It's a simple game, Lonnie. We tried to make it difficult.
Out the back
sometimes.
Of the end zone will be just fine. Ready to go.
There it is.
This time he drills it down there, and he will angle it toward the sideline, and it's going to go out of bounds at the 3.
Well, it was a good kick. It just the wrong bounce there at the end. It needed 2 more yards on it.
Commerce will get the ball at the 35-yard line. I guess they do have the option of having the Huskies re-kick, but 35-yard line is a pretty good stuff. Well, they are going to have them re-kick. I was about to talk about how nice it is to be able to start at the 35, but they're going to try it again. So
Well, we just saw that Travis can kick the ball all the way down around the 2-yard line, just straighten it out a little bit. Shin, of course, out of Rockwall. Got a chance to visit with him earlier in the season. Nice young man. Don't underestimate the importance of a good kicker, whether it's special teams, field goals, extra points. Need to have a good punting game. I mean, sometimes when you've got a young, inexperienced team, special teams ends up being the area where you have problems. But it really hasn't been a problem for HBU this year.
Well, the third time's a charm. Let's see if it is for the Huskies. This time he'll go back to a short kick. It's going to come down at the 26-yard line, taken by Fields, and he angles it back to the right side, turns a corner, slips as he tries to cut back, but out across the 45 to the 47-yard line, a good return, and there's why you don't take it at the 35-yard line, I guess.
Yeah, looks like they made the right move right there. So, but, again, last time HBU was put in this position defensively, they forced a 3-and-out. We'll see if that's in order again this time. Lonnie, you came in from Lubbock today and spent a little extra time on the airlines there, didn't you?
Well, I didn't spend any extra time actually in the air. I spent a lot of extra time at the airport. Hand off, first carry of the afternoon for the Commerce Lions, and it's Deontay Taylor on the carry.
And coming back, looks like on a penalty right here, usually holding in this situation. Well, face mask, actually, against the offense. A lot of pushing back.
So wipe out the big gain on the first down play there, and that'll be 15 yards stepped off against Commerce. Now, some of you old-time football fans know that Texas A&M Commerce used to be known as East Texas State University. There's actually a little bit of a connection for Coach Vic Sheely. A little bit of history. We'll tell you about that with East Texas State or Texas A&M Commerce. There's a bobbled snap by Stewart, and he's pressured. And let's see, the Huskies get back there in a hurry. Stewart comes up with a football, but it'll be a sag back inside the 20-yard line, back at the 16.
Yeah, let's see what happened here. You can see Harrison there trying to pick it up, and he was trying to pick it up standing up, and it almost cost him. Harrison Stewart finally picked it up there at the end, though, to retain possession, but that's going to force a long second and probably, what, 35 yards?
It's a long way to go, that's for sure. They need to get to the 43 in HBU territory. Pass on second down and downfield and broken up by Prince Sam. Intended receiver that time was number 88, and that is Kerry Fellers.
Yeah, look at Prince Sam down the field. Got his hand up in the face at the last second. Nice job right there, and that will force third and very long. Drop those safeties back. Let them have anything inside of 15 yards from the line of scrimmage. And then make a tackle when we get the ball back.
Third and 35. Hand it off. And this is Garrett. Garrett carries it out across the 15 to about the 19-yard line.
Yeah, Taylor Thompson over there on the hit out of Belleville. Player down on the field. There's also a flag down.
And the flag is going to be an illegal shift called against Commerce. It'll be declined because it'll bring up fourth down. Now let's check on the Husky. That looks like Kafo Tua, who's having a tough time getting up.
Yeah, 49 right there, Kafo Tua, and that would be a big blow. He's out of Bedford, Texas, went to L.D. Bell High School. Of course, a 6-foot, 285-pound defensive tackle. We've called his name out so many times this year. He's really instrumental on that defensive front.
Coaches raved about his performance in the Sam Houston State game. They were really impressed with him, and he basically earned himself a starting spot that night. He's up now.
Yeah, he's definitely leaning on that right knee, it looks like. So So I hate to see that, but it is fourth down now and 35 yards to go for Texas A&M Commerce.
Looks Zach like Lazarine back deep.
I think the momentum has certainly swung back in favor of HBU now. And now that they get the ball back, see if we can tie this game up.
And they should get it back in pretty good field position. High, wobbly spiral. Get away from this one, Huskies. And it's going to bounce at the 48-yard line and be down right at the 50. And so half the football field to go. The Huskies will start this possession.
Well, they learned from the Incarnate Word game that after the trying to field a punt and letting it hit one of their own men upfield, you just want to get away from it in that situation. And yeah, they will start on the 49-yard line of the Lions. So great field position, great opportunity here for HBU with 7:46 still to play in the first quarter. It's a quarter that has had a lot of scoring.
Well, a lot of incomplete passes, a lot of stoppages of the clock. Baker hands it off to Kelly. Kelly slips through an ankle tackle, stays on his feet, gets inside the 45 down to the 44-yard line. Turns that into a 5-yard gain.
B.J. Kelly runs so hard and determined. I would just lean on him for a while, kind of establish this running game up front, and then that'll open up the passing game as we move along.
Second down and 5, two backs in the backfield, Day and Kelly. Bibbins split out to the left side, short side of the field, two receivers out to the right. Handed off to Day, tries to turn the corner, slips a tackle, and gets inside the 40. He'll have a first down down to the 36-yard line.
Great run right there by Day. Just got to some open field on the right-hand side, but really two or three of these tackles were just arm tackles, and he was able to shed right through them. You like to see that in a running back. You know you're going to get hit. Can you break a couple of tackles along the way and pick up the yardage necessary for a first down? Well, Day did it just there.
Clock rolls, 6:47 and counting. Fake the handoff. Now, Baker, I'm not sure he wanted to hang on to that, but the mesh point didn't connect between he and Kelly, and he takes it forward. Gets back to the line of scrimmage. It'll be second and 10 from the 36.
Yeah, that's a quick communication play right there. You've got to make that decision right away whether or not that defensive end comes in on the side will determine whether or not Baker, the quarterback, is going to hand it off to his running back, in that case Kelly, or keep it. And at the last second, it looked like by no choice of his, Baker had to hang on to it.
Second down and 10, operate from the far hash mark, hand it off to Kelly this time. Not much up the middle. He gets a couple of yards. Met by Matt Claggett.
I think here in the early going, HBU is trying to kind of soften up that defensive front for the Lions and see if they can force the ground game to work. But it'll be an interesting call right here. Third and about 8, looks like.
Set up at the line of scrimmage. Darian Lazard in the slot to the left side. Bibbins wide that way. Wesley Lewis out wide to the right. Baker wants to throw, but will tuck it under. He gets forward to about the 30-yard line. That's going to be short of the sticks. And this is kind of that no man's land, too far to kick a field goal, too short to punt. So it looks like they're going to go for it here on fourth down.
Yeah, Fraser Taub right there on the tackle. And I thought Baker might have picked up enough right there to at least – welcome a field goal opportunity, but perhaps not with the ball in the 30. That would be at least 47 yards.
There's no wind here to speak of today at the stadium, so that won't be a factor no matter which direction either team is going here this afternoon, unless something kicks up later on in the afternoon. Here's the fourth down play. Baker on the keeper takes it forward in second effort. He might have gotten the first down. It looked like he might come up short. But I think Kadarius Baker may have gotten the first down there.
Well, for those of us who followed Navasota football last year, you saw a lot of this, and Baker just put that head down, knew where he had to get for the first down. That's so important out there, young quarterbacks. Know where the first down marker is. Look at it on the sidelines before you snap the play so you know where you've got to get to make that first down.
Well, they're going to bring the chains out. It's going to be close. The homecoming crowd here is ready to cheer a first down, and looks like they will.
So that fourth down call looks to be the right one right there, with Baker keeping the ball and picking up the first down. Let's not forget the 16 games he played last year. That's like dipping into freshman college season right there. Right. You know, he needed that extra time. Navasota winning the 3A state title last year, and Baker, first game of the season against Sam Houston State, came off the bench, showed a lot, and just like Kafutua, he got a chance to start right after that game.
First and 10 from the 26. Baker wants to throw down the sideline, has a receiver. Wesley Lewis makes the catch, touchdown, Huskies.
Wesley Lewis, what a fantastic grab. Looked like he kind of caught it with almost one arm there and had to look into the sun on top of that. Look at the pass here by Kadarius Baker. Rolled out, saw Lewis open, and Lewis did catch it with one hand. How about that grab? Wesley Lewis at a Rouse High School in Leander. Talked to his coach last week about him, and he said, yeah, he's going to be a difference maker in college, and he was right there.
Shen kicks the extra point up and through, straight and true, and 4:19 to go here in the first quarter. Brand new ball game. The Huskies have tied it up, 14-14. You're watching it on the Legacy Sports Network, presented by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation.
You better double check that, my friend. Don't think we don't know who you are.
Yeah, I'm Aaron Rodgers.
No, that's not it. You're that State Farm discount double check guy.
Discount double check.
Thanks to the hundreds you saved us, we could upgrade the grill class.
Grill class?
Your tongs are in your seat back.
Save with the discount double check today.
Discount double check.
Get to a better state. State Farm.
Tie ball game now, 4:19 to go in the first quarter. Talking about the history between Vic Shealy and this A&M Commerce team. Coach Shealy's father was a coach for many years in the college ranks and coached at Carson Newman College, a Division III school. Check a Division II school. Finish it up here in a minute. There's a kick that bounces, hits the turf. It's still loose, and there's a scramble for the football. The officials are going to have to get in there. We'll see. It looks like one of them is already signaling A&M Commerce has the football.
And yeah, almost a break there for HBU. And with the way things have been going with 14 consecutive points to answer that 14-0 start for A&M Commerce, you'd like to think maybe we'll keep Uncle Mo on our side. But unfortunately for the Huskies, the Lions come up with a football here. But still an opportunity for the defense here for HBU to force another three and out.
Stewart back to the line of scrimmage. Wants to throw on first down. Swings a pass out intended for Smith and led him too far. Incomplete. Fortunate if you're an A&M Commerce fan that thing wasn't picked off by Prince Sam, who was making a charge that way.
Yeah, threw that ball kind of into no man's land right there. Seems to happen a lot in the Houston area, huh?
Stewart wants to throw across the middle of passes, tipped, almost picked off there. That was Terrell Brown who got a hand on it, laid on the turf thinking about that one for just a minute.
Yeah, Brown maybe should have had that one, but nonetheless, it is now 3rd and 10. And I don't think there's any question. We've kind of figured out the Lions don't really like to run the football very much.
Well, now's not the time to start. 3rd down, and they send the running back out of the backfield anyway, and there's a whistle before the snap, and we're going to have a false start. It's going to get a little bit longer here for them. So anyway, quickly to finish up my Vic Shealy story, his dad, coach at Carson Newman, had a national championship game against East Texas State several years ago, and Coach Shealy was talking about his dad losing that game that day. Carson Newman lost to East Texas State. So he said maybe this is the day he can avenge his dad's loss against what is now Texas A&M Commerce. Here's a handoff to Garrett. Garrett slips to the outside. He's got a seam and out across the 40 near the first down markers out to the 43-yard line.
Yeah, Cody Moncure on the hit right there. So, yes, a surprise. The Lions can run the football, but nice tackle right there, and Moncure may have kept him from getting the first down.
Jonathan Garrett, freshman out of Center, Texas.
Yeah, I think the Lions want the officials to measure this one. It looks like they will now. If I'm the Lions, I measure this just to find out how far they've got to go.
The play clock is in motion, still plenty of time, but now it looks like it will be officially fourth down, and there's movement by the Huskies, and this is going to move the chains. Free play and throwing downfield. The pass is almost picked off by Jahalen Norris, but it's going to be for naught as the Huskies were pulled offside by the count or maybe just trying to be aggressive there. Five yards, though, are going to be stepped off, and that's going to move the chain. So had an opportunity there to hold them on fourth down, but it will be a first down at the 49-yard line.
So in case you're wondering, Texas Tech did win last night over HBU, 76-61. Pretty competitive game, though, for the Huskies men's basketball team on the road in Lubbock.
Yeah, it was a nice evening for a very young team, and the Huskies are going to be pretty good this year. Here's a handoff. Stacked up in the backfield is Garrett, and he is going to be wrapped up. Jahalen Norris is in there. Taylor Thompson, Garrett Dolan, you name it. The guys who've made plays all season for the Huskies were in on that one.
And that's what you'd like to see, kind of a swarming defense, several blue shirts to the ball. Now second and long.
They want to throw on second and 11. Swing pass across the middle, underneath route, and it's caught. And that's Vernon Johnson who makes the catch, gets into Huskies territory down to about the 45-yard line.
Yeah, open on that play right away. You see he kind of came out of the slot, rolled to the left, and really way too much time for Harrison back there just kind of to observe all the checkdowns. Got to get a little more pressure on him if you're the HBU defense.
John Westby may be a little fortunate there. He looked like he was trying to strip the ball, and now Huskies jump off sides again at the snap and make contact this time, so the play is whistled dead. But
I don't think there's any question. Harrison Stewart has great size at 6'5", 245, and really stands in that pocket to the last second. Maybe that's why the Huskies were trying to get a jump on him right there and a flag for offsides.
Our official today doesn't have a microphone on, but if you read his lips, he called number 64 Austin Holly's number. And Austin was just the one they recognized because there were two or three blue jerseys offsides. Here's a swing pass out to Jordan at the 40. He makes the catch, turns it up inside the 35-yard line. He'll be bumped out of bounds. Taylor Thompson over there to make the hit. 6 yards on the gain, down to the 34, though.
Even Jackie Robinson Jr. made a hit on that play from the out-of-bounds area. Jackie going down right there, number 25.
34-yard line, second and four. Stewart wants to throw, has the time, and overthrows his intended receiver. Look for Stacy Howard that time.
Yeah, it looked like an opportunity there for an interception on top of that. Jahalen Norris was kind of in pretty good position there, but I think by the time he realized where the ball was, a little too late to try to make a diving effort.
Bring him back to the line of scrimmage. They line up in a modified T formation, and they hand it off to Garrett. He takes it right up the middle. A hole opened up. And he gets into the secondary and down to the 26-yard line, and that's good enough for a first down.
Yeah, I like what you said, though, the modified T formation. They've actually started to show that they can run the football here for a couple of plays.
Swing it out to Johnson, makes a catch, and takes it inside the 20. Just as you say that, they go back to that little short passing game again.
And that's what they're known for. I mean, that's almost like a running play for them.
Mm-hmm. Picks up 8 on that play, 2nd and 2, and now they'll hand it off to Garrett. Garrett has a 1st down inside the 15, ridden down at about the 12-yard line. And this methodical drive keeps going.
Yes, yeah, setting up the pass with the run. They've switched it up a little bit on this drive.
1st and 10 at the 12 inside the red zone. Stewart has plenty of time. Looks to throw. Has a receiver. It's caught. Touchdown.
Yeah, great grab right there in the front part of the end zone by number 88. That's Kerry Fellers. He's a wide receiver out of Burleson, Texas. Went to Burleson High School. Watch how he just goes up and just says, "That's my ball. I'm taking it." That's what you got to do when you're a receiver. 3 defenders all around him, but he was the one that came down with it. Anytime your quarterback puts that ball where it's kind of hanging up there for a little bit, it is your job as a receiver to make sure you come back to the ball. If not, it's going to be picked off.
Low snap on the extra point attempt, but a good recovery by the holder. And that is Joshua Brown, and the extra point is good. So A&M Commerce has recaptured the lead here. Under a minute to go in the first quarter. You're watching HBU Huskies football presented by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation on the Legacy Sports Network.
Have you recently lost your job or been denied medical care? Has your doctor told you their panel is full and they cannot take you? At Pasadena Health Center, we make healthcare affordable and provide access to reliable, quality healthcare in a caring atmosphere. We offer services in family medicine, dental, OBGYN, pediatrics, x-ray, lab, and pharmacy. We accept Medicare, Medicaid, private insurance, and offer discounted fees for self-pay patients. Pasadena Health Center, where caring is what we do best.
Huskies got down by 14 points early in this ball game. In fact, in the first 2.5 minutes of action, they trailed by 2 touchdowns. They got those back, but now here with just under a minute to go in the first quarter, they've gone back down after a nice scoring drive by A&M Commerce. A high short kick comes down to Tanner Peavy, and he returns it this time out to the 30-yard line, and that's where HBU will set up shop here.
Yeah, a lot of scoring here in the first quarter. It's 21-14, in case you're just joining us. Texas A&M Commerce leading HBU. And it's really been a quarter where the momentum has just completely changed at least 3 times. It started off, it was 14-0. Texas A&M Commerce was just making a couple of really key plays, but you didn't feel like they had sustained anything as far as a really long, impressive drive. It was a 3-play drive, really highlighted by 1 big play. But then the 2 drives by HBU to get back in it. Now we'll see what they've got down 21-14.
Baker with the 2-back set, hands it off to Larry Day off of his left shoulder, and Day gets out across the 30 to the 32. Just 2 yards on the carry. Second down, call it 8 yards to go. Hibbler over the football for the Huskies. And Baker gets the snap from him. Play fake, wants to roll out, throws it out of the backfield. It's Craig Bell who makes the catch out across the 35 to the 36-yard line.
Take a look at this play one more time and find out what happened. I like the 2-back set. They run the ball well out of it, but now they can use it for play action, and that's exactly why that play worked right there. Anytime you can come out of some play action when you've been running the ball well out of that formation, I tell you, Craig Bell Jr., he's the perfect one to throw to in that sort of play, and that'll wrap up the first quarter.
15 minutes in the books, and the Huskies in a tight one here, 21-14. They trail by a touchdown. You're watching it on the Legacy Sports Network, and it's brought to you by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation.
Football fans, I see a Raising Cane's tailgate in your sights, and I'm not saying it's going to be easy,
but you have it in you to tackle that tailgate. To devour enough fresh, never-ever-frozen chicken fingers and cane sauce to make tailgate history. Show thirst who's boss with sweet tea and lemonade. Not by the cup, but by the jug. Because this is our house. And today, you eat with the best of them. Raising Cane's, one love. Official sponsor of all things that make game day delicious.
Change is inevitable. Time waits for no one. And those who look only to their past are rarely ready for their future. Never underestimate our ability, because after all, we are Texans.
-14 here as we come back to Crusader Stadium. Lonnie King along with Jeff Power. Glad you're along for the ride here this afternoon. If you can't be here for homecoming weekend at the stadium, the next best thing is to be right here with us on the broadcast this afternoon. And, Jeff, it's been, as the scoreboard might indicate, a fairly even first half.
Well, when was the last time you heard of 38 plays in the first quarter alone? A&M Commerce with 123 yards, HBU with 155, pretty even. HBU with a big advantage on the ground, 126 to 15, but the passing yards in favor of the Lions at 108 to 29.
Of their 20 offensive plays, 14 have been passes, 6 rushes, just 15 yards net on the ground. Now, they've had a couple of big runs, but one of them was wiped out by a penalty, and then some tackles for losses have wiped out some of their other gains.
And, of course, the B.J. Kelly with 87 yards, most of that on a 75-yard run.
First down for the Huskies. Baker on the option. Keeper has a seam out across midfield into Commerce territory, and the ball comes loose, and it's going to be recovered by the Lions, and that's the second fumble. Let's see. Now we're getting the officials whistling. And the Huskies offense is coming off the field.
And once again, Baker's probably thinking he may be down, but he didn't argue it too much, so tough break for the Huskies.
Well, you saw the defender coming up from behind, and you got the feeling that Baker had no idea he was being trailed that closely.
But how could you not? I mean, you're the man with the ball. I mean, you got to tuck that thing away. I mean, there's 11 guys on the other side of the ball. You know one of them's at least chasing you. But a nice job of getting some decent yardage right off the top. Good fake right there. Cuts back. Needs to switch hands right now. Get that ball in the left hand. That's where the mistake happened, and he dropped the ball.
Well, and you got to give some credit, too, to the defensive back. That was Pablo Vasquez, the senior out of Duncanville, Texas, who just came up from behind and basically punched the ball out of Baker's hand.
Vic Sheely talking things over right now with the officials. But it will be the Lions football.
Some discussion there. You see Vic Sheely talking with the officials. I think the question here is about where the ball should be spotted. They've got it spotted at the 37. Coach Sheely's pointing back closer to around the 30-yard line.
And Vic says, I'm not coming off the field. You get this straight. Yeah, I mean, it does make you wonder, why is the ball spotted right now at the 37? It seems like it should be back. They're going to talk it over here, looks like, a little bit more, maybe with the opposing coaching staff, just to make sure we're all on the same page here. And I think you alluded to this earlier, first-year head coach for A&M Commerce, and what a great job he's done as well. I mean, you come into a season where you're 1-9, and you're not expected to do much, and they look pretty good.
Stewart has a receiver downfield. It's Johnson makes the catch at the 20, spins around and spun around by Cody Moncure, and finally brought down at about the 10. But a big play on first down, and you can see the quick strike capability of this offense.
Yeah, wide open downfield. He had about 3 or 4 yards behind him and then had to wait up on the ball, or that would have been 6.
Cody couldn't get him wrapped up for about 10 yards. Here's a handoff to Garrett. Garrett's going to be met at the 10-yard line.
Nice job there by the Husky defense right there, stepping up and making a big play. Anytime you get inside that red zone, need some good stoppage there, and that's Taylor Thompson there feeling pretty good about what he was able to do. You know, Kobe Cartell, we were talking about him earlier, Cartell with A&M Commerce, first-year head football coach. They definitely like to run a spread formation, and they like to throw the ball around a lot.
Second down and goal. Here's a pass intended for Smith near sideline, overthrows his receiver. Fellers was in the vicinity as well, and coverage pretty good that time by HBU.
Matt Storm is the offensive coordinator for A&M Commerce, and you see so many schools now running the spread offense in the state of Texas, whether it's high school, college. It's no wonder why there's over 10 starters in the NFL from the state of Texas.
Wants to throw and has a receiver tipped away. Great defensive play by Ori Bankel, who recovered nicely to knock that ball away at the last second.
Yeah, Ori Bankel got that arm out there and used that 5'10", 165-pound frame to bat that one away at the last second. Nicely done.
Stretched all the way to 5'11 on that.
Needed every inch of it.
Well, now it's fourth down, and they're going to send the field goal unit on. Saul Martinez, junior out of Pittsburgh, Texas. Pittsburgh Pirate.
Very fitting mascot.
And the 26-yard field goal attempt is up and through. And so, tack on 3 to the lead for A&M Commerce. And now they open up a 24-14 advantage here with 13:39 to go in the first half.
You go through the eastern part of the state and you think that you're up in the northern part of the country. You've got Pittsburgh, Texas. There's Cleveland, Texas. Detroit, yeah. Texas.
Up by Pittsburgh, there's Atlanta.
Atlanta,
there's,
yeah.
Yeah.
Even Paris, if you want to take it worldwide.
Then you go a little bit below those areas and you think you're in the Middle East somewhere. In
Palestine.
Athens, Palestine.
Well, and there's a lot of good football out there, too. I got a chance to see Kilgore and Gilmer mm-hmm. play last night. It was a fantastic football game. In fact, it was an unusual situation for the Gilmer head coach. He had to allow Kilgore to score because they were inside the 10, and the clock was around a minute 20, and Gilmer only had a one-point lead. And you wonder, as a coach, would you ever do that, allow the other team to score? But he felt like that was the only way they could win because he just thought they'd kick a field goal. And coaching staffs, like, you know, with Vic Sheely and all, they'll tell you, hey, you know what? You got to do what you got to do to win the football game. And in some all cases, right. It may be that you have to allow your opponent to score. But if you recruit East Texas alone in the greater Houston area, which HBU does a fantastic job of, you can win some championships. There's a lot of good football players in the eastern part of the state of Texas.
Well, and one thing we've talked about from time to time on air and off air, just you and I chatting about it. One of the things that HBU now offers to some of these guys from East Texas, from the Houston area, that may have gravitated to schools like A&M Commerce and other schools around the region, is a Division I opportunity, FCS opportunity, to play football in a major metropolitan area. And I know the coaching staff is hoping that as they hit the recruiting trail next week, that'll be something that appeals to a lot of potential recruits. Here's a short kick. It's going to bound down, and the Huskies have to fall on it. It's still on the turf, and Commerce has come up with it.
Yeah, they were kind of fighting over the ball right there, and that's a tough break. Just underway here in the second quarter, and we've talked about how Uncle Mo has swept back and forth. Well, it's certainly on the Texas A&M Commerce side, and I think both players that are on the ground for HBU both thought the other one was going to come up with it.
Leo Migo, number 54 for A&M Commerce.
I think there's enough blame that could go around in many areas. Let's look at that replay one more time if we can, because I don't think there's any question. I guess Jordan Wirt there had tried to fall on it. He thought that another man was trying to fall on top of him, but someone else needs to come in and pick that ball up.
Stewart wants to throw on first down, and over the middle, the pass is tipped, and Garrett Dolan got his paws on it and then slams the turf because he thought he should be carrying it back the other way. Garrett got a pick six in an earlier game. Let's go back
here
to this.
Here was that play, yeah. So they just kind of laid on top of each other, both thinking that the other man had it. I know Zach Lazarine was kind of near the football, just need better awareness of where the ball is on the field. But you know what? That's why they kicked it into that area.
Handoff on second down. Give it to Garrett. Garrett bounces away from Dolan and carries it forward. Stayed on his feet. Gets down to about the 21-yard line, and that's going to be an 8-yard pickup.
Yeah, I will say this. When the Lions have decided to run the football, they've been very effective at it.
Huskies go with the three-man front. Do some maneuvering along that front line. Here's a quick swing pass out to Vernon Johnson, and he makes the catch. He'll have a first down inside the 20, down to about the 18-yard line.
And I take out the play right here. Nice reception, and just pushing him out of bounds there at the last minute. Looked like John Westby.
Move the chains. It's first and 10 in the red zone. Stewart under some pressure. Unloads, though, and the pass is tipped again. And about the third deflection by the Huskies here in the first half. And was that Terrell Brown again? He's reacting as if he thought he should have had that one.
Yeah, ball's kind of tipped around and incomplete. We'll bring up second down. So some missed opportunities on this drive for the HBU Huskies.
Second and 10. Throw again. The pass again goes through fingertips on both sides of the football. Horry Bankole this time had a shot at it for the Huskies.
Anybody else want to get that peanut butter off the field already?
Wow. Harken back to the good old days of the Stick'em.
Think about the Oakland Raiders. Yeah. We had all that Stick'em on the sidelines.
Fred Biletnikoff. Ball couldn't get away from him if it wanted to. Stewart to throw, and down the sideline has a receiver. Did he step out of bounds? I think he did. Vernon Johnson made the catch, but the official up the sideline has his hat off, and that usually indicates he went out of bounds before he made the catch.
Okay, so let's see. Here's the bat. Yeah, he was certainly out of bounds. Yeah, because I was going to say the catch was certainly in bounds. But stepped out on the way down the field. Can't do that.
Vernon's reacting like he doesn't know the rule.
He was a good 2 or 3 yards out of bounds, too.
Well, whether you're forced out or not, you can't leave the field of play and then return while the ball is still alive. And so, well, no matter that he caught it inbounds, it was still an incomplete pass. We got a timeout called by A&M Commerce. They're going to decide what to do on 4th and 10 here. Take a break. 12:31 to go in the second quarter. Huskies trail. You're watching it on the Husky Sports Network, powered by Legacy Sports and presented by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation.
When you have a medical emergency, think Physicians ER. You will be seen by a board-certified doctor in less than 10 minutes. With immediate results on labs, x-rays, and CAT scans. For emergency care greater than urgent care, think Physicians ER. Accidents happen anytime, any place. When you need to be seen fast, visit Physicians ER. Visit physicianser.com for a location nearest you.
Out of the timeout, A&M Commerce has decided to attempt a field goal here on 4th down and 10. It'll be a 35-yard attempt from the far hash mark. But first, the officials are talking something over here.
And I think if you're the Lions, going for the field goal here is the right choice. I mean, it is 4th and 10. It's so hard to pick up that kind of yardage near inside the red zone. Chance to tack on 3 more points and extend that lead to 13. Hard to believe, but it's just 12:32 to play here in the second quarter.
Martinez gets a kick away and nails it from 35 yards out. Gets it through and extends the lead now out to 27-14. So 3 touchdown drives offensively for A&M Commerce here in the first quarter, and then they come back and add a couple of field goals here early in the second quarter. But if there's a bright side for the Huskies, off these last 2 drives, they've only given up 6 points, so they're still in this ball game.
Yeah, the defense kind of a bend but don't break attitude here in the last couple of drives, but thanks in part to turnovers, though. So they did what they had to do, and HBU is fortunate that these were only field goals and not touchdowns. But important right now to get a good sustained drive for this Husky offense.
Well, the best success has been on the ground, and if not for the 2 critical turnovers, and not to throw all the blame in any one direction, but they've both been committed by Kadarius Baker here in the first half. If not for those, the Huskies would be going toe-to-toe with this A&M Commerce team right now. High short pooch kick. It's going to come down. Tanner Peavy takes it at the 26. Dodges a wedge man flying by and stays on his feet out across the 30 to the 31. They still can't bring him down. The play's been whistled dead.
Yeah, that's when players get hurt in situations like that. Officials got to do a better job of getting in there and stopping that. Looks like a rugby scrum sitting there for about 5 seconds.
Seen a lot of discussions here in the first half among this officiating crew, and that's usually a sign that these guys are trying to figure out things on the fly. Baker and company back out to the line of scrimmage, trying to generate some offense here. Kadarius has 2 backs in the backfield with him. Larry Day, B.J. Kelly. And handoff to Day on first down. Not much there. Maybe a yard out to about the 33.
Yeah, trying to keep that defense honest right there with the handoff there today. We look at the quarterback matchup so far here. There's Harrison Stewart and Kadarius Baker, and the one stat you don't see there for Baker is the two fumbles, but the fact that he's actually been pretty effective all season long as far as the passing yards, but the rushing yards minus 33. So he doesn't run the ball very often, and today they were trying to establish that, but he's turned it over twice.
Pump fake. Throws sideline intended for Ethan Fry. I think Fry looked like he gave up on the route. The pass was overthrown, and I think Ethan thought maybe there was somebody behind him that it was intended for.
Yeah, that ball was overthrown, though. There was no other blue jerseys in the area. And Baker was kind of motioning to one of his other receivers to maybe cut his route a little shorter, a little bit of extra pressure coming in. Maybe he was looking to dump it off and didn't have any choice.
3rd down and 9. Huskies offense wants to stay out there a little bit. Clock has stopped. 11:39 to go till halftime. Baker with Kelly in the backfield wants to throw. Now pressured, and he's going to be sacked. Had time for a minute, but the pocket collapsed, and he's hit in the backfield.
Yeah, that's a nice play right there by Cameron Rogers. He's quick. Every time Rogers has gotten in there on Baker, he brings him down immediately. Watch how quick 55 is in on this play, right up the middle. Bam. You get that close to the quarterback, you got to tackle him, and that's what Rogers did right there.
So the loss is back to the 26-yard line. That'll bring up 4th and 16 now. And Duncan back out there to punt the ball away. Line drive spiral. It's going to come down to Roger or Check It Johnson, or that is Fields, out across a 40, 45, 50 into Huskies territory. And Cody Moncure bumps him out of bounds at the 48.
10:43 to play here in the second quarter. This is a pretty important defensive opportunity here for HBU, trying to hold Texas A&M Commerce from they've scored on their last couple of possessions here, and with already basically a 2-touchdown lead, you want to try to keep them at bay here as we approach halftime. It is the first day game of the season here for the Huskies, but weather not a factor at all. It's actually perfect conditions for football. Overcast, no sun.
Hand off on first down. They give it to Garrett, and he will be wrapped up. Keith Ewing is right there. Transfer from Washington State out of Bel Air High School. And actually, Kafo Tua got there first, and Ewing, number 20, there just there to help out and wrap up.
Good to see Tua back out there.
Yeah, here's Fellers on the catch. Slips away, and the Huskies having some trouble tackling and bringing him down, and Fellers carries it down inside the 35 to the 32-yard line.
Yeah, Fellers was able to pick up that first down by just some extra churning there at the last second. Got to do a better job of wrapping up and tackling. That's what happens sometimes. You try to force a turnover and you give up yardage.
Here's a pass. It's complete. Out on the sideline and making the reception that time is Jordan Jenkins, a junior out of Orlando, Florida. Flag down, though, and let's see what this is about.
Yeah, this flag came pretty late. Could be holding. We'll see. And it is going to be marked off against the Lions.
An eligible receiver down the field.
That was one of those late flags that comes in only in those kind of calls. There wasn't any procedure, and the only the play would be only the penalty would be holding, but it wasn't on that case.
Probably the official looked up and saw a number in the 70s down the field and said, "You're not supposed to be here." Back him up. It's still first down and 15 now. Stewart wants to throw down the sideline, has a receiver swatted away at the last minute. And that's Prince Sam, and he's pointing toward his shoulder as he gets up, and hopefully he's okay. But
the way he's kind of holding that shoulder there, looks like he might have got some sort of stinger or something.
It was a previous completion to Jenkins.
They've been picking up some yardage after the play, yards after carry. And, we've got Sam. A player down. Yeah, Sam, I think he realized that Texas A&M Commerce was going to snap the ball if he didn't hurry up and get off the field, and he finally had to just go ahead and take a knee. Here is the pass play. Watch Sam right here. Let's see what happens. He kind of leaned in, might have somehow hurt his arm in the process of trying to swat that ball away. He was kind of – it kind of looks like he's got a dead arm there on the right because he kind of limps off the field here.
You get some attention from Emily Kohut, the trainer for the football team. Harrison Stewart back behind the line of scrimmage. This time he's pressured, slips away from an arm tackle. Huskies again could not wrap up, and Stewart turns it into positive yardage. Kept the play alive, and
yeah, you want to feel pretty good about yourself when you get a sack, but somehow Harrison Stewart breaks out of it, switches the ball into the left hand and throws an elbow and picks up about 10 more yards. But that's just enough to get him back to the original line of scrimmage.
Number 90, Matt Aikens, got in there. He's lined up at the inside lineman spot. Here's a throw down the sideline, and it's knocked away at the last minute.
I tell you what might have been a break right there that helped out more than anything else was the sun coming out perhaps at the last second. Watch how he's looking up into the sun. And that's the previous play to kind of set up how this one would end up being wide open downfield. We'll see if we can get that one queued up for you here in a second, the pass play in the corner of the end zone. Of course, with the lights could be a factor, but the sun literally came out right as that ball was being thrown. You can see some of the shadows on the field.
Three receivers out to the right side of the formation this time, and Stewart again gets the rush and avoids it, takes it inside the 30, and he's going to be grabbed by Akins and just yanked out of bounds at about the 23-yard line, and that is close to the first down marker. But yeah, they're going to say he was short, so that'll go back over to the Huskies on the fourth down attempt.
Well, it wasn't pretty, but HBU will take it. We'll see if the offense can now start clicking.
That defensive front got some pretty good pressure on him that time, but he just slipped through the seam. It seemed to flow right by him, the pressure from the defensive front. See, Akins just grabbed some of that jersey and say, enough of this.
This is the formation that's worked well for HBU, especially running the football.
And they fake it to Kelly and swing it out to Bell out of the backfield. He takes it to the sideline, picks up a first down and more out across the 35 to the 36.
Yeah, good call right here. I think you can do a lot out of this formation. They fake the handoff here to B.J. Kelly, toss it outside to Bell. Bell gets a good block, picks up the big first down, and then some.
Move the chains, reset the clock, and it rolls. 8.5 minutes to go. Here is Craig Bell again, and he carries out to the 40 this time, giving 4 yards on the first down carry.
I tell you, when you see Bell and Kelly, they look very similar out there, the way their running styles, that single digit. But they both really compromise each other well.
Craig Bell out there, the lone back this time, and takes a handoff from Baker, runs it to the right side, turns the corner and gets positive yards. Out near midfield, out across the 45-yard line. Well, they're going to say his knee hit at the 44, it looks like. So give him 4 yards on the carry. It'll bring up third down in about 3.
Yeah, Bell's going to take the handoff here and pick up the necessary yardage to make for an easier play call for the offensive coordinator here for HBU. And Scott Smith now, instead of worrying about third and long, he's got a 3rd and 3 decision to make. And back on the field is B.J. Kelly.
Commerce showing like they might blitz. Here's a pitch on a reverse to Darian Lazard. His first touch, and he turns it around, takes it up inside Commerce Lions territory, and that's a first down at the 43-yard line.
That's a good play right there. B.J. Kelly took the handoff, dropped it over to Lazard, and look at Darian Lazard's speed. Another U of H transfer here, picking up the first down. I can see Bivens get back into the playbook here as far as getting the ball to him on the outside. He lines up number 85 on the far side of the screen.
They've only thrown his direction one time here in the first half. It was caught by Ken, but he couldn't stay in bounds. Here's a pass to Lazard. He makes the catch at the 37-yard line. And that's going to be a 6-yard pickup on first down, so it'll be 2nd and 4.
And Lazard takes a little breather here. Looks like he might have got the wind knocked out of him there for the way he was kind of reacting when he first got up, but big yardage there.
Handed off to B.J. Kelly, who's back out there. He's hitting the backfield. Met by John Q. Jones, a 6'1 junior out of Compton, California. A lot of Californians on this A&M Commerce team.
So Bell checks back in for B.J. Kelly. Well, actually, it's both Bell and Kelly on the field now, side by side. We talked about how they complement each other. Well, we'll see. Opportunity here to use a screen or perhaps even some sort of draw play. We'll see. 3rd and 6.
Lost a couple of yards on that last carry. Baker play fake. Wants to throw, intended for Fry, and again overthrows him. And Fry was in between a couple of defenders but just couldn't get in position to try and leap up and make that catch.
Yeah, it's one of those split-second decisions. And watch here, the fake handoff here to Bell. And, yeah, Fry was certainly open right there, but just overthrown by Kadarius Baker.
So it'll be 4th down, and at the 39-yard line, A&M Commerce is going to call a timeout. We've still got 5:55 to go here in the first half of play. Huskies trail 27-14. You're watching HBU Huskies football presented by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation on the Legacy Sports Network. Fourth down, and as we come back to Crusader Stadium, the Huskies set up to punt the ball away after failing to convert a third down opportunity. And David Duncan is out there at his own 48-yard line. Sends one down the field and angles it toward the sideline, and it's going to be a beauty. Goes out of bounds at the 3-yard line. A great job by David Duncan. And the Commerce Lions will be backed up deep in their own end of the field.
Yeah, David Duncan at a Hyde Park Baptist in Austin, just the coffin corner there in the corner of the about the 3-yard line look like. So Texas A&M Commerce will be looking at a 97-yard field in front of them. You know, Kobe Cartel, he's done a great job here with Texas A&M Commerce. This is a team that, again, was 1-9 last year, but they haven't been to the playoffs in nearly 20 years. Colby coming in trying to turn things around here for him. He was a defensive coordinator, but for a while there they were a regular in the postseason. You know, traditional powerhouse. You know, Vic Sheely, I'm sure, could tell you some stories about his days there at Texas A&M Commerce as well. And this is an important defensive stand opportunity here for HBU. You've got them pinned back deep in their own side of the field, 5:47 to play. You're hoping you can get the ball back onto the offensive player's hands, maybe with about 2 or 3 minutes to play, maybe around midfield if you can hold them.
First and 10 at the 3-yard line as they bring their offense out. They're going to operate from what looks like a Wildcat-type formation.
They're just trying to move it out of the back of the their own side of the field here.
Derek Davis is in at quarterback. Davis, a 5'10 senior out of Arlington Bowie, and
there we go.
On the keeper, he is drilled at the line of scrimmage and pushed backward. They're going to give him forward progress out to about the 4, so officially it's a 1-yard gain, but not much there.
Yeah, Terrell Brown, the third, wearing number 36, in on the hit. And as was number 40 there, Garrett Dolan. And Cody Moncure.
Davis again. Now he bluffs to run, and he's going to throw down the sideline to Thompson, and the pass is caught. Check it, Vernon Johnson makes the catch at the 46-yard line. And how he managed to hang on to that one, I think that was Cody Moncure step for step with him. Let's see. No.
Yeah, Ari Hinton, perhaps?
Hinton. Sure was.
And he was kind of had good coverage. Sometimes you just got to tip your cap.
Great concentration by Johnson, yeah. Hand off. It's Garrett up the middle, and he's going to plow his way forward inside the 40. That's close to a first down. They'll mark him down at the 39-yard line. Give him 9 yards on that carry.
Yeah, I don't think HBU saw that play coming, the deep pass. You got a backup quarterback in there. He's more of a running threat. Looks like they're just trying to get the ball off the back shadows of their own end zone, and they go up 50 yards downfield.
Johnson catches a little swing pass out in the flat, turns it up, and picks up about 6 yards, and that'll be another first down. It's an effective offense for A&M Commerce. A little bit of the old run and shoot style offense, those quick hitch passes, and let the receivers gather the yardage after the catch, and then they got a nice little mix of the running game as well. Here's a pass across the middle. It's Seth Smith, and he makes the catch for a touchdown.
Yeah, once again, a Texas A&M Commerce receiver had his man beat downfield, and a beautifully thrown ball there by Harrison Stewart, right on the money for a touchdown.
Extends the lead out to 33-14. Extra point attempt to come. Martinez back out there. .409 to go till halftime. The extra point is good, and now it's 34-14.
Yeah, 34-14, tough break. We'll see if HBU can bounce back here with 4:10 to play in the second quarter. We'll be right back.
I think I have the window seat. You better double check that, my friend. Don't think we don't know who you are.
Yeah, I'm Aaron Rodgers.
No, that's not it. You're that State Farm discount double check guy.
Discount double check.
Thanks to the hundreds you saved us, we could upgrade the grill class.
Grill class?
Your tongs are in your seat back.
Save with the discount double check today.
Discount double check.
Get to a better state. State Farm.
Coming up at halftime, of course, the homecoming festivities here on the field. But Jeff and I will have a couple of visitors here at the half to chat with. You mentioned earlier that we had an interesting return from Lubbock after the game last night and intended to talk with Ron Cottrell, the head coach of the basketball team. But he has still been delayed. Here is a punt return, or check it, kickoff return by Taylor Thompson, who muffed it and then picked it up and got it out to about the 4 or 5 yard line before he was driven back into the end zone. And this is an unfortunate turn of events for the Huskies.
Yeah, there's a little bit of a lack of communication there right at the last second. And I don't think the sun was as much a factor as just the communication side of it. Lucky it wasn't called a safety. If you think about it, really, Texas A&M Commerce hasn't really outplayed HBU as far as physically on the field. They've just made some bigger plays. There's been a lot of mistakes by HBU here in the first half. A couple turnovers. A lot of penalties.
4:02 to go till halftime. Backed up deep in their own end of the field, 95 yards away from pay dirt. And they will hand it off on first down. It's B.J. Kelly who carries it out to the 10. He picks up a quick five. So the goal here is to just try to get some points back before halftime. You don't have to get it all back right now, but I know the Huskies would like to go into the locker room with a little bit of momentum on their side. Second and five, handed off Kelly again, and this time the middle closes up as he tries to take it in between the tackles and spun around, thrown down at about the 11, so it'll leave a third and four to go.
Yeah, big play call right here. They've run the football up to this point to try to run a play that the defense is allowing you to run. The fact that they don't have everybody in the box, eight in the box, you're thinking there might be an opportunity to run the football, but we'll see here, third and three.
Big drive, big down on this drive, trying to keep the football out of the hands of that Commerce offense. Baker, pressure, flushed out of the pocket, on the run, throws, has Maxwell Brown, overthrows him, incomplete. Brown had it go off his fingertips and then took a pretty good shot that time from Traven Johnson, a freshman defensive back out of John Tyler High School.
Watch Kadarius Baker. Looks like he's going to get hit right here by the goal line, just kind of ducks out of the way. Then the throw to Maxwell Brown. He must have heard some footsteps, too, coming up behind him because he was clocked.
So it'll be fourth down. You don't mess around in this portion of the field, and David Duncan will come on to kick the ball away. His job here is to try and unload a good punt here to send the Lions back into their own end of the field, and he will get a pretty good roll. It's going to roll dead, though, right around midfield. And again, Danny Garza down there to down it after snapping the football back to Duncan.
Yeah, so Texas A&M Commerce, once again, they will start on HBU's side of the field at the 49-yard line. Important for the Huskies' defense to stiffen up here. Looks like they've got too many men on the field at the moment. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. No, we're good. Just checking.
You know, you mentioned earlier.
I can tap next door. For some reason, yeah. There's more
hey,
than 11.
Hey, coach. We see something here. Three receivers out to the right side. Single back set. Stewart to throw. Underneath has a receiver. It's completed. Making the catch is Tevin Godfrey, a 6-foot junior out of Gilmer. And there you go. You saw Gilmer last night. Mm-hmm. Here's one of their grads.
A lot of good athletes out there in East Texas, and Gilmer is certainly one of them. Number one team in the state, but they lost last night to Kilgore.
Picks up 4, 2nd and 6. Here's a pass out to Smith. He of the touchdown reception makes the catch and jostles his way down to the 40-yard line, just shy of the sticks. It'll be 3rd down and a yard to go.
There's going to be a timeout on the field for an injury timeout. And I also saw Coach Reyes over at Nacogdoches High School, and I was talking with him this morning. He said that he used to coach with John Jenkins, former University of Houston coach. They run the spread out there. They had an 0-10 season last year. This year, 7-3. And best record they've had in 43 years. But a lot of teams moving to the spread offense. You see it up and down, high school, college, and it develops a lot of good quarterbacks, and there's a lot of good coaches in the state of Texas at the high school level, and I know Vic Sheely's going to get a chance to see a lot of them here and on the recruiting trail.
Gafo Tua jumped that time. Now, he reacted as if he saw movement in the offensive line, and then that's why he jumped and pushed the offensive lineman. But they're going to call it offsides on the Huskies. And goes from 3rd and 1 to 1st and 10 with the 5-yard penalty. And now we've seen that about 3 different times here in the first half.
Yeah, penalties can be a killer. And right now with a 1:45 to play in the first half, last thing we do is give up any kind of points.
Stewart throws a little slant route. Intended that time for Stacy Howard. The pass is incomplete.
Yeah, this one kind of looked like it just slipped through the hands there. On top of that, maybe a little high thrown, but nice job on the defensive side there by John Westby.
2nd and 10. Stops the clock. Every incomplete pass impedes our progress toward the halftime celebration here. But he's back to throw on 2nd and 10. Has a receiver. Seth Smith makes the catch. Gets out of bounds at the 25-yard line. And that's right at the sticks. And they're going to move the chains. That's a 1st down.
Yeah, inside field goal range as well. We've seen a couple of field goals here from the Lions already. I think the difference what you're seeing on the field is a Texas A&M Commerce team that's just been they've taken advantage of their opportunities.
Stewart wants to throw. Pressure comes from the outside. Now he's going to get out of the way, but he'll be wrapped up. Garrett Dolan came in there and joined Kafo Tua to bring him down, but he did manage to turn it into about a 1-yard gain.
Yeah, this quarterback, we found it. Stewart is just hard to bring down. You need a couple of guys to do it, and we'll see if they can get a little more pressure with 1:08 to go. Ball passed here and dumped off in a little swing pass. And that was to number 8 there for Texas A&M Commerce, Stacy Howard. Might have heard there, 3rd and 4. We'll see. Big play right here for the defense here for HBU.
Stewart throws intended for Smith, and a flag comes in. Now a 2nd flag comes in, and Cody Moncure might be rung up here for defensive holding or pass interference. We'll see. It's going to be pass interference. In college, that's a 15-yard penalty. The ball inside the 20, though, it'll be stepped off at half the distance to the goal. Now check it. They're going to step off 15 yards all the way down inside the 4. So it'll set up first and goal at the, let's call it, the 3-yard line, just outside the 3. 40 seconds to go. Huskies trying to keep A&M Commerce out of the end zone here one time before halftime. Derek Davis back out there at quarterback. And he will throw left-handed pass, and it's complete to Jenkins in the end zone. Jordan Jenkins makes the catch for a touchdown.
Yeah, that's a tough break right there. Didn't want to give up points here this late in the half, 36 seconds to go, but nonetheless, that little play right there has worked a couple of times here for Texas A&M Commerce, and Jordan Jenkins was just wide open right across the middle. And how about their backup quarterback just coming in at a moment's notice, Derek Davis, and making a great connection. A couple of big passes from him today.
Martinez nails the extra point again. He's got 5 of those here in the first half and 2 field goals to go along with it. So a pretty good first half for Mr. Martinez. And it's 41-14 with 36 seconds to go. This game mirrors a little bit in some regard the Abilene Christian game. The Huskies hung tough for a little while, and then all of a sudden it kind of got out of control with a couple of turnovers and failures to be able to move the ball on offense. And you look up and Abilene Christian was up 41-12 at the half, and right now it's 41-14 here.
Yeah, it was a tie ball game a little while ago. It was 14 all, and then at one point HBU had the ball down 21-14, but they were driving. You felt like they had an opportunity. There was a turnover, and then there were some missed opportunities with just some penalties and the defense not quite holding Texas A&M Commerce the way you'd like. I mean, when you got a defense pinned inside their own 5-yard line, the last thing you want to see is a 50-yard pass give it up, but that's exactly what happened.
Frosch is ready to kick it away for Commerce. He's going to send one down the field, squibs it down there, and it's going to be taken by one of the upbacks out across the 35 to the 38-yard line. And on the return that time for HBU, it's Jordan Wirt, a junior transfer out of Katy High School in Texas Lutheran.
So we'll see what HBU decides to do right here. Kadarius Baker will be in the shotgun formation with B.J. Kelly and Craig Bell Jr. on either side. 30 seconds to play here in the half. Do you go for it, Lonnie?
We'll see what they're going to do. First and 10, and they'll hand it off to B.J. Kelly, and that kind of gives you the impression that they may just be ready to take it into the locker room here.
Not going to go for it. Well, you certainly don't want to add to Texas A&M's Commerce's point total, and I think maybe Vic is thinking right now, you know, I've kind of seen enough here in the first half. Let's go sit down and talk about this.
And that's what they'll do. Clock winds down to 0 here in the first half, and the Huskies will take it to the locker room. And as they head that way, they find themselves down by 27 points. After a pretty good first half where they were outscored 21-14, they were dominated in the second quarter, outscored 20-0, and it's 41-14 here at the break. We will take a timeout. When we come back, Jeff and I will have an update on the first half stats, a couple of guests to stop by here at the half, and we'll tell you all about it when we return. You're watching HBU Huskies Football, powered by the Legacy Sports Network and brought to you by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation. Halftime of our game between the HBU Huskies and the Texas A&M Commerce Lions. Lonnie King and Jeff Power along with you. And the Huskies trail here at the break on homecoming weekend. 41-14 is our score. And, Jeff, when you look at the first half stats, one number jumps out at you, and it's the passing yards for A&M Commerce.
Yeah, 295 yards passing to only 49 so far for HBU.
Wow.
The Huskies have had some luck on the ground, 174 yards rushing, whereas A&M Commerce only has 48. But that is a glaring stat, the passing yardage. And you knew coming in the Lions like to throw the football. But I think the key was they made some big plays. I mean, when you've got them pinned down inside their own five and they complete a 50-yard pass, that's just killer. Then there were some penalties. There was pass interference in the end zone, a couple of turnovers by Kadarius Baker. And this was a game that was tied up 14-all. I don't think there's any question the Huskies felt like they could play with them. But then all of a sudden, second quarter, wow, what happened? 41-14 here at halftime now.
And no doubt the turnovers were critical. One led directly to a fumble return for a touchdown, and the other one set up a scoring drive for A&M Commerce.
Yeah, both by Kadarius Baker, and he had negative 33 yards rushing for the season coming in, so I think they wanted to try to see if they could run the football more with him. He showed some good moves, but once you get out there in that open space just beyond the defensive front, you got to really secure the football, and at least on one occasion, didn't do a good job of securing it, and the ball was knocked out from behind, and you know, just kind of took the wind out of the sails.
On the flip side of that, the defense had several opportunities to come up with some interceptions of their own, but they failed to convert those. And, you know, it's never one thing, but it's a combination of things. The turnovers and the failure to create turnovers kind of worked against the Huskies.
Yeah, missed opportunities. I mean, I don't think there's any question the HBU defense, they kind of bent, but they weren't breaking until really late in the second quarter. But, I mean, they definitely had their opportunities. I mean, there was three consecutive plays where the ball was tipped by someone, and at some point it went through an HBU defender's hands, but they couldn't come up with it.
So some opportunities out there on the field, and we'll see if the Huskies can take advantage of those in the second half. A big hill to climb, 27-point deficit here at the break, 41-14. But we will take a break, and when we come back, a special guest joins us here at the half. Donna Finney, the women's basketball coach here at HBU, will step in and we'll talk about a big win they had on opening night. All of that when we return on the Huskies Halftime Report. And you're watching HBU Huskies Football on the Legacy Sports Network, brought to you by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation. Halftime of our game between the HBU Huskies and the Texas A&M Commerce Lions. It's homecoming weekend. That's always a big weekend on the campus of HBU. It's also the time that we can talk about starting up the basketball season. And this year, we have a chance to visit with the new women's basketball coach here on campus of the HBU Huskies. Donna Finney stops in. And Coach, first of all, welcome in.
Thanks.
Glad to have you here at the half. And let's talk for a minute, first of all, before we talk about your experience here at HBU. Let's talk about last night.
Yeah.
The immediate results, a nice opening night win against the University of Texas Arlington Mavericks.
Yeah, I mean, it was a great start for us. We've talked the last few weeks about committing to defense, and I was so proud of the way our kids did commit last night to defense. I'm sure the people that were at the game last night will tell you it wasn't pretty offensively, but we got it done, and really proud of the effort that we gave, and it was important for us to get that first one under our belt.
Now, you're in your first season as head coach, but you certainly are no stranger to HBU. You've been on the staff here for a few years with the Huskies. What's it like moving over a chair and taking over that first seat?
I mean, it's definitely different. You know, obviously, having been a head coach at home for almost 10 years, it felt good to be back making the calls again. But having recruited all of the kids that are on our roster and, like you said, having worked with them for several years, it wasn't that big a transition. I think we've changed the way we're playing the game, and definitely, you know, we're utilizing some individuals in different ways, but I'm excited. I'm excited by this group, and I'm excited by their energy. I mean, the gym last night was fantastic. The students that came in made a lot of noise, and we got a great support for our opening game. So we hope to see them back next Saturday.
Now, quickly, you mentioned being a head coach back home. Let's tell everybody, obviously, they can tell you're not from Southeast Texas.
No.
But you were the head coach of the Scottish national team.
Yeah, was heavily involved in basketball over there and was involved with the Scottish national team and the Great Britain program, and working with their youth programs and also talent ID for the Olympic program for the 2012 Olympics. So, you know, I have traveled a lot and been in a lot of countries, but now I call Texas my home, and I'm excited by that.
Now, the last couple of years, Shanice Steenhold has been a name that's kind of risen to the top. She last night was, I think, maybe just your fourth leading scorer, though, and you've had some other players step up, especially in last night's game.
Yeah, it's been a focus of ours that if we're going to be consistent in winning games, we have to have contribution from a number of players across the board. And I thought our guards did a tremendous job last night. Rachel Arthur has really stepped up, and from her freshman year now, I'm calling her a super sophomore, and she really stepped up last night offensively. I thought we got great contribution from one of our freshman guards, and Heidi Sivola, who's from Finland. She really steadied us when we needed it. She hit a couple of big shots and made some great decisions. So, you know, I think that's going to be a strength of ours this year, that we do have contributions from different positions. And, you know, Shanice is happy with that because it takes the pressure off her a little bit.
Yeah.
But, you know, she still, when it mattered, Shanice still stepped up yesterday. And, you know, we got into a little bit of foul trouble and she had to sit a little bit. But I know she's ready for Thursday night's big game.
And let's talk a little bit about that, because you've got not only are you taking over the reins, but you've got a non-conference schedule that's going to lead you up to the first season of Southland Conference play. Talk about the excitement over participating in the Southland Conference this year.
I mean, it's really exciting. I think, you know, the girls talk about it because they're enthused about, obviously, the automatic bid that's now up for grabs.
Right.
And, you know, we're realistic in terms of where we're at, and we're just taking each game as it comes. But I think our non-conference schedule really sets us up for the Southland. We've got some pretty challenging road games, none less than the game at Baylor in mid-December.
Yeah.
But I think it really tests us. We also have a non-conference game against Sam, which is the back end of a contract we had to play. And that's going to really test us because, you know, coming after such a great year for them last year,
right?
When we go up to Huntsville in a week and a half, and we'll see where we're at. And
but
it'll maybe be a great judge for us.
Maybe in your favor, that's a nice opportunity to get to see them.
Absolutely.
With this current squad and not have to pay a price in the conference.
Well, like I say, I think it's going to show us where we're at, because they had such success last year that, you know, we'll see where we really need to develop going into the Southland.
Now, later on this week, you mentioned the Thursday night game. It's a road game, but it's here in town against Texas Southern, so fans can come out and see you.
Absolutely.
Not have far to go. And then your next home game is when?
Saturday against Southern Utah. 6:30 on Saturday, we have a volleyball game and then our game, and it's going to be a big Saturday in Sharp Gym, so we hope to get as many people out as possible.
Hey, congratulations on the opening
Thank
night
you.
Win. Whole lot more to come this year, we hope, for Donna Finney and her team. We'll take a break, and when we come back, A little bit more of the halftime report. You're watching HBU Huskies football on the Legacy Sports Network, presented by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation. Halftime of our game between the HBU Huskies and the Texas A&M Commerce Lions. It's homecoming weekend, and the Huskies would like a little bit happier number right now on the scoreboard, 41-14, Jeff. There have been some bright spots, though, individually for the Huskies. B.J. Kelly has had a nice first half rushing.
Yeah, 94 yards rushing for B.J. Kelly. That's been a pleasant surprise. But I think overall, you look late into the second quarter. We had held them to a couple of field goals midway through the second quarter. It was still a game, 27-14. And then those two late touchdowns were just killer. Yeah. And they were pretty big drives, too. The Seth Smith 34-yard pass from Harrison Stewart, and then also the Jordan Jenkins 3-yard pass from Derek Davis. And Derek Davis had a couple of big plays for the Lions in the first half as well. Might remember that 50-yard pass from their own end zone. And that, you know, that was at a point in the game where we were talking about, okay, pin them deep. Get the ball back around midfield, score, and you go into halftime down 27-21. Man, that seemed like a long time ago. But, hey, you know, we've talked about this before through the season. This is a game that right now you kind of wipe that slate clean and go out and play that second half and see if you can win the second half. You owe it to the fans out here. You owe it to yourselves as a team that has actually been pretty good so far in their inaugural season. Go out there and show everybody what you can do.
Well, if you're the coaches right now, Do you consider opening up things and opening up the playbook, opening up the roster, and maybe getting some guys out there to see how they're going to perform this afternoon and look ahead to the future?
Yeah, I don't see why not. I mean, it is the final game of the season, and I think you want to give some guys a chance to prove what they can do. And, hey, you know what? Boost up their confidence.
Tanner Peavy takes the kickoff here to start the second half, and he's taken a few of those high short kicks in the first half, and he will take it back out across the 30-yard line. And, in fact, they'll spot it right at the 30, and that's where the Huskies will set up shop here in the second half. First offensive possession.
And Peavy, one of those players where, you know, he gets in at running back. He plays kind of multiple positions, and here he is returning a kickoff. So maybe the roster is changing a little bit here as we begin the second half.
Peavy joins B.J. Kelly out there. 94 rushing yards in the first half for B.J. Kelly, so he's knocking on the 100-yard door here. A swing pass on first down. There's Kenneth Bivens, and I think that's his first official catch of the day.
Yeah, they only threw one to him in the first half, and he was out of bounds even though he caught it. And he's been such a big part of their offense the last 3 weeks, so that's probably something they talked about at halftime is look at your key players. Get the ball to Bivens. Let's use that running game. Let's not just abandon the whole game plan here. Let's see what we can do.
Gets 6 yards out to the 36-yard line. It's second down and four. Just underway here in the second half. Baker takes a snap, almost bobbled it, but hands it off to Peavy, and Peavy tries to fight forward for some yardage. Check it. That's Craig Bell, number three on the ground there, you see, who checked in for the second down play. He'll get a couple of yards out to the 38. Be a third and two situation now. One thing I don't think you want to do ever, but especially here out of the locker room at the half, is give the ball up three and out.
Yeah, the opening part of the third quarter is always key in football games.
Baker, option pitch, goes to Kelly. He'll have the first down, finds a seam, cut through a couple of defenders. He was down on the ground. You saw the ball pop out. But the official right on the spot, the linesman there, signaling that Kelly was down by contact at the 48-yard line, and that's a first down for the Huskies.
So nice play right there. You can see Kadarius took a big hit, but he did his job by hanging onto that football as long as he possibly could and then made the pitch. Nicely done.
First and 10 at the 48-yard line. Huskies trying to move into Commerce territory for the first time in quite a while. Handed off to Kelly. Slips away from a tackler, but the play is stretched out, and he just cannot quite get around the corner. Maybe got a yard to the 49. Be second down and nine.
Another player that you might see a little bit more getting the ball out to him in the second half might be Darian Lazard. So I'm kind of talking with one of the coaches here on the sideline. That probably was discussed at halftime as well. Find your key players out there.
Ball at the 49. Baker wants to throw. Has Lazard. There you go. And makes a catch. Still on his feet. Slips past the would-be tackler. Got a block from Kenneth Bibbins as well. And he's going to pick up a first down at the 41-yard line.
You can see Lazard. He kind of had that that mojo working right there towards the end. But watch the play. Good pass here by Kadarius Baker. Nice little touch pass here. And Darren Lazard. Usually you don't want a guy moving back and forth like that. But that extra movement got him the first down.
Did a good job that time to make Marcus Four miss on a tackle and picks up the first down. Here's a handoff to Kelly, and he's met at the line of scrimmage and ridden backward. Brandon Turner, big number 98, junior out of Allen High School.
Yeah, Lazard, he's now lining up on the near side this time, and Bibbins on the far side of the field. Two of the key components, both University of Houston transfers.
Second down and nine from the 40-yard line. Baker under pressure. He's going to be wrapped up and dropped. Came from the backside and wrapped up by Tevin Moore. And dropped in the backfield right at the 50-yard line. A 10-yard loss on that sack.
Yeah, Baker didn't have hardly any time at all. As soon as he got back, two defenders on him very quickly. He was going to try to step up in the pocket, but both the defenders there for the Lions just cut that play off.
Third down, 19 to go. They need to get down to the 31-yard line, see what they've got in their bag of tricks here. Fake the handoff to Kelly. Now they slip a screen to him backside, and he makes the catch. But he's wrapped up. A&M Commerce did a good job that time to read that play and keep it from becoming a big game by the Huskies.
So it will be a punting situation here for HBU, and at least one positive play there to Lazard, but credit the Lions defense right there for stiffening up with some good blitz packages there.
Under 11 minutes to go here in the third quarter. First possession of the second half for either team, and the Huskies move the ball a little ways up the field, but we'll have to kick it away, and Duncan out there gets pressure up the middle, and it's blocked. Ball is still on the turf, and it's going to be covered up by Garrett Dolan, but no matter, it's going to be A&M Commerce football in HBU territory.
Yeah, one thing you can see here about Texas A&M Commerce, they just come. They were coming for a block from the beginning. Three different players broke through the line of scrimmage. Got to do a better job of blocking up front.
They'll spot it at the 43-yard line. With 10.5 minutes to go here in the third quarter, A&M Commerce comes out. And they've still looked like they got all their starters out there with a 27-point lead and looking to add a little more. Here's Stewart, makes the pass completion to Seth Smith, and that's about an 8-yard gain at the 37-yard line. One thing I think it's important to note here, Jeff, is while this is the last game of the season for the Huskies, A&M Commerce still has two or three more to go, and they're going to be conference games for them. And so they're still trying to keep their offense in high gear and want to keep their starters in a rhythm. So don't expect to see them let up too much here in the second half.
Yeah, and, you know, they're 6-3 overall. They've had a good season, and they've done pretty well in conference play, as you had mentioned. Their record is just below 500, but they got a couple games left. We'll see if there's still maybe a way for them to possibly make the postseason.
Illegal motion is called. Garrett got the handoff on second down. He was wrapped up for no game, but they're going to step off 5 yards. It would have been 3rd and 3, but instead it'll be now 2nd and 8 for Commerce. So Coach Vic Sheely says, let's make them work a little bit harder here. And they'll redo 2nd down. Fake the handoff, throw to Jenkins, and he's hit right as the ball got to him. Cody Moncur delivered the blow, but Cody looks like maybe he took the worst of that.
Yeah, let's take a look at this play one more time. Yeah, big hit right there, and Cody, yeah, he definitely he came down quickly. And I think not only was Moncur a little shaken up on that play, but so was Jordan Jenkins. He was kind of hobbled up there too.
Those receivers, you know, hate it when the quarterback stretches them out over the middle like that.
Yeah, no one wants to get hurt, and it's a non-conference game. So, you know, for Texas A&M Commerce, and they're going to need those guys down the stretch.
Coach Sheely out there to take a look at his safety, and Cody is up, and he's a little wobbly.
Yeah, you don't want to get up and start moving too fast. I think the coaching staff, the other training staff said basically, hey, hold on. Because, you know, you kind of wake up, you're a little woozy, and you get up and you think you can run off the field, and all of a sudden the ground starts moving.
That's youth. He'll get a little older and learn not to do that. Cody, a freshman out of Fort Bend Travis High School.
And he can hit. He's been a good football player for him this year.
Here's pressure coming from the Huskies. Cameron LaCroix and Garrett Dolan were in the backfield, and Stewart just unloads it.
Yeah, so good pressure right here on the outside, and that was kind of the difference. Kind of, in fact, look at the movement right there up the middle. Did you see the play there by Garrett Dolan, just knocking his offensive lineman to the ground and getting to the quarterback and making him throw it just a little bit quicker than he wanted to?
Almost looked to me like Cameron LaCroix, number 82, was held on that play by the offensive lineman for A&M Commerce. No flag. So no harm, no foul, but now it's fourth down and movement. And LaCroix comes in there, and he gets a little delivery.
Well, I think Jordan DeCourt might have jumped there, so, yep.
They'll back him up 5 yards, and so the coaching staff for A&M Commerce says that's enough of a penalty that we'll punt it away now. Frosch is out there to punt the ball. Saw him a couple of times in the first half. Two punts, 53 total yards, so a 26.5 average in the first half for Cameron Frosch. Huskies come with pressure. Now they're going to throw on fourth down and incomplete. And, wow, didn't expect to see that at all.
Yeah, and I'm not sure that was the design play. But from the looks of things there, it sure appeared like it was a design play. But the coaching staff there for Texas A&M Commerce didn't seem too thrilled about it. I don't know if that was something that maybe they had changed in the line. Cameron Frosch, the punter for Texas A&M Commerce, it looked like he had no intent to punt whatsoever, and it wasn't like he was pressured. So
one of the Huskies coming up the middle got a hand on that ball, too, and deflected it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But either way, it's a big break for HBU. They get the ball at the 46-yard line. Excellent field position. They've got to take advantage of this now, though. Even their punter wants to throw passes.
Well, they had over almost 300 yards passing in the first half.
First and 10 for HBU. Second possession. Here's a pass. Swing it out to Wes Lewis. He makes the catch across midfield down to the 49-yard line. That's a 5-yard gain on first down.
Yeah, you'll take that all day long. And Lewis ran up about 3 or 4 yards, turned around, the ball was right there. I'm sure Scott Smith and the coaching staff here for the Huskies, they worked that play. It's kind of a timing pattern. If the defense is going to give you that 5 yards, go ahead and take it.
Two receiver set, two back set. Here's a handoff to Craig Bell. Bell down to about the 47-yard line. Give him a couple. It'll bring up third and short, third and three at the 47-yard line.
So big play right here for HBU. Anytime you get in a third and short situation, I'd stick with running the football. They've been more effective on the ground.
Two backs in there again. Bell and Kelly. And Baker will fake the handoff to Kelly, swing it out to Bell. He's got a little bit of room out on the edge, turns it up. He'll have a first down, gets down to the 41-yard line, and that'll be enough to move the chains.
Yeah, I like to see that. Craig Bell Jr., nice play right there. They faked the handoff because there were just too many players coming up in the middle of the box. Nice job for Kadarius Baker to get it out to Bell, and Bell knew where that first down marker was and just lunged forward.
Give him the 39, so add on a couple of yards to that game for Craig Bell on the stat sheet, and it's first and 10 from that spot. Baker to throw, has a receiver, it's Wesley Lewis, but tipped away at the last minute. Fields got his hand up and knocked it away. Otherwise, the Huskies might have had six there.
Well, we've talked about how the receiving core for the Huskies, one of the bright spots for the team this year with Bibbins and Lewis and Darian Lazard, and Baker got this ball up a little too high, and unfortunately for HBU, they weren't able to come up with it.
Second down and 10, 39-yard line, A&M Commerce side of the field. Hand it off. It's Kelly trying to sweep it out. He turns it back to try and turn the corner, but he's going to be pushed out of bounds, and we've got flags on the field. A loss on the play, a 3-yard loss back to the 42-yard line on the carry, but let's see what this flag's about. It's going to be against the Lions.
Yeah, so there's a break. And that's going to be an automatic first down, as you see. So keep this drive alive and keep moving the football.
Personal foul. That's going to be a 15-yard step off. And now there's some question about where to step it from. Start to run it off from the 42, but it should be the 39. And they'll get it down to the 24-yard line. At this stage of the game, you take 15 yards any way you can get it.
Yeah, and you know, as we mentioned, right now in the second half, you're not worried about 41-14. You're thinking 0-0 right now. Win the second half. This is the last game they're going to play at Straight Jesuit College Prep. All the rest of the games from this point forward will be on campus over at HBU. You want to give your players something to walk away and feel positive about.
Two receivers out to the left side. Lazard in the slot. Handed off up the middle, though, and it's Kelly on the carry. Finds his way forward. He's over 100 yards now in the ball game and gets it down to the 20, a 4-yard pickup there.
Yeah, let's take a look at that play one more time as the handoff up the middle of Kelly and some hard-fought yardage right up in front. Run behind that big offensive line. We'll take 5 yards on first down all day.
Baker to throw, heads to the corner of the end zone for Bibbins and had it knocked away at the last second. Bibbins almost had a TD there, but a good job by Traven Johnson, the freshman defensive back out of Tyler, who knocked it away.
This was a nicely thrown ball by Baker to Bibbins here, and Bibbins almost had it, but literally the last second it was knocked away.
I gave the defensive back a little credit there, and I think Bibbins just had that go through his fingertips.
He normally makes that play. We've seen him make that kind of catch this season.
Here's a reverse. Third time we've seen this play, and it's Lazard. Inside the 10, down to the 5. The ball comes out, but he was out of bounds. Hit hard at the end of that run, but he's down to the 6-yard line. And that play has worked effectively every time they've run it.
Here comes Lazard. He's got that speed. You see Baker out there trying to get a block on somebody, and you can hear that pop from all the way up here.
First and goal at the 6. Huskies need points on the board right here. 6:40 and counting to go in the third quarter. Baker handed off Kelly up the middle. Gets a couple inside the 5. Actually, they'll say he's down right at the 5, so give him a 1-yard pickup on the play.
And it's always difficult to run the football this close to the goal line, but the Huskies got to find a way to get it into the end zone here. Get Uncle Mo back on their side.
Send Lazard in the slot out to the left side. Bibbins out that way as well. Wesley Lewis alone on the right side of the formation. Maxwell Brown, the tight end, is tight to the left side. Kelly in the backfield. Coaching staff in the booth next door trying to get him to run the play before the clock expires. Pitch to Kelly, heads to the corner. And he's wrapped up at the 1 yard line. Almost got to the pylon, but just not quite.
And usually in this situation, Day comes into the game and try to work him in and then use that extra strength that you might get from him. But I like the way Kelly runs the football down around the goal line. And he and Bell are in there side by side. We'll see.
Third and goal from just outside the one. Two back set. Baker now looks back, gets the play called on the sideline, relays the info to his line. Handed off, Craig Bell, he's gonna be close, but wrapped up short of the goal line, and no decision to make here. You go for it on fourth down and inches. Trailing by four touchdowns, and
yeah, they're bringing in the big old boys now.
So fourth and goal, the Huskies trying to push it across.
Chris Hill in the game, number 72 on the offensive line.
And Lazard is going to set up at the QB spot now on fourth and goal.
That's a run right behind Chris Hill on that left side. There you go.
He's going to hand it off to Kelly. Kelly into the end zone, touchdown.
Anytime a lineman comes into the game in that situation, you know they're going to run behind him. That's maybe a package they've worked on throughout the season. But nice job also by the extra push. Check it out here. Lazard hands the ball to Kelly, and then he gets a push by, looks like by a Lions player. Texas A&M Commerce with a little help there at the end.
41-20 now. Extra point attempt to come. 4:20 to go here in the third quarter. Duncan gets the snap from Garza, puts it down, and the kick by Shin is up and through. And now Huskies have cut into the lead. First score of the second half belongs to HBU, and it's now a 20-point differential. 41-21, you're watching it on the Legacy Sports Network, presented by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation.
When you have a medical emergency, think Physicians ER. You will be seen by a board-certified doctor in less than 10 minutes with immediate results on labs, x-rays, and CAT scans. For emergency care greater than urgent care, think Physicians ER. Accidents happen anytime, any place. When you need to be seen fast, visit Physicians ER. Visit physicianser.com for a location nearest you.
B.J. Kelly thanking his offensive line for the assist on that little touchdown. More of a leap than a run, but you see he's a little pumped up there on the sideline. Huskies now trail 41-21 and set to kick it off. And
in my book, it's 7-0. HBU is up right now. We wiped the slate clean in the second half. Try to win this second half, and who knows, in the process of trying to win the second half, you might win the game.
Well, you want to send your defense out there right now and hope that they give you a three and out, or at least a good solid defensive stop here on this series. High short kick, it's going to come down, and fair catch signal for and made by Tevin Godfrey at the 31 yard line. And so Huskies defense will come on out, try and put the clamps on this A&M Commerce offense.
Yeah, I think right now, you know, the crowd's pretty fired up, pretty spirited with the homecoming festivities at halftime, a little bit of an extended half, you know, a chance for the players to kind of rest up and kind of make some adjustments. Some new players on the field. We'll see how things change.
First and 10, Stewart still out there at quarterback, and he's going to look to throw on first down. Has Fellers underneath, makes a catch and slips by a defender down the sideline, still on his feet and bumped out of bounds inside the 30 at the 29-yard line.
Fellers been pretty good today. He gets out in the open space, and he's tough to bring down. He runs hard. He's fast. Usually hangs on to the ball when he makes the catch. He's one of their top receivers.
little underneath route designed to be about a 4 or 5 yard route, and his ability to get away from Garrett Dolan there is what sprung him for the big game.
Yeah, Dolan's got to be a little more aggressive right there. And at least if you don't think you've got a chance to go straight on, make sure you cut that corner off at least and use the sideline to your advantage. It's like having an extra defender over there. You want to work that man to the sideline. If you got to give up 5 yards to do it. But don't give up 30 yards like what just happened.
Player down for A&M Commerce back up at the line of scrimmage, the previous line of scrimmage. It's Jordan DeCourt, 6'6", junior, from Kailua, Hawaii. Now, Jeff, I've got to ask the obvious question. How do you go from Hawaii to Commerce, Texas?
Well, you
know.
That's
love of the game right there, buddy.
That and maybe opportunity to play football at the next level. Maybe didn't get too many other opportunities, and he's in college right now.
Stewart throws that underneath route again, and this time has Vernon Johnson. And Johnson makes the catch, and they're going to that and having some success with it.
And let's maybe figure out why. They're getting a good enough push from their offensive line. But more importantly, it just seems like their quarterback's done a nice job of just finding the open man. He goes through all of his reads and finds the open man.
Here's Smith on a jet sweep, takes it to the corner, gets to the pylon, and into the end zone, touchdown.
Yeah, that's a good call right there. And quickly answering the HBU touchdown is Texas A&M Commerce, as Seth Smith just broke to the outside there and just found a way to get in. Got some good speed. That is definitely the jet sweep in all sorts of ways that you could think of.
Well, I think one of the things that those last three big plays showed is that their receivers just have maybe a step on the defenders for HBU here. They're just about a step quicker on every one of those plays. Here's the extra point attempt, and it is good. And as quickly as the Huskies cut the lead down to 20, it goes right back up to 27 with 3:36 to go here in the third quarter. 48-21 following the touchdown run by Seth Smith.
Well, it was a good series for Kadarius Baker that last time out, but we'll see. You know, maybe here in the near future we might see Jonathan Fleming come into the game at backup quarterback. I mean, at some point, you know, you need to kind of help build that confidence back up. Fleming was your starter when the season began and didn't play as well as he would have liked, I'm sure, against Sam Houston State, but got in that ACU game earlier in the year in the fourth quarter, has played kind of sparingly since then, but I think there's a chance we might see him, but I'm sure they'll bring out Baker for at least one more series here.
3:36 to go in the third quarter. And it might be that fourth quarter turnaround that is the magic time that we're looking at to see some of the other Huskies get out there onto the field here. We'll see how they respond on this possession. Likely the last time they'll touch the ball in the third quarter. You know, no matter the outcome of today's game, though, it's been a good first season for Vic Sheely and his staff. They've learned a lot about this squad. They've learned where some of their strengths are, and I think you'd have to look at running back and wide receiver as those strengths, and now they have a better idea of where they need to go out and find a few players as well.
It never hurts to have a couple more extra linemen, offensive linemen, defensive tackles. It's always important.
Tanner Peavy on the return, trying to keep it alive. Sidesteps a couple of ankle tackles. Stays on his feet out to about the 34-yard line. And that's 28 instead of 29, so that's not Tanner. That is Xavier Izanagu.
And, you know, the word is out that HBU's playing football. I travel around the entire state of Texas. I'm at a different high school football game every Friday night, and I often talk with coaches about their players and what their future looks like. And, you know, you're hearing more and more of them recognizing the fact that HBU football is something that maybe some of their kids might want to be a part of.
Baker still out there, quarterback. He wants to throw, has Darian Lazard, a little timing route out to the 40-yard line, makes the catch. He released that before Lazard turned around, but they were on the same page, and Darian makes a nice catch for a six-yard gain, second and four to come.
And I think if you're a player out there at the high school level, you want to see that HBU is competitive. And I think when you see right now they have a 3-3 record and still the chance here to finish at 4-3, why wouldn't you look at him?
Wesley Lewis cut that route off. He stopped as if he thought he was going to get a back shoulder throw, but instead Baker launched it down the field. So heard the coaches in the next booth pound the desk. And I'm not sure who that where the fault lies on that one. Maybe it was Baker who misread it. Maybe it was Lewis who cut the route off too soon. Either way, it's going to bring up 3rd and 4. Two back set. Larry Day, Craig Bell. Play fake to Bell. Throw a pass, and it is caught by Lazard after the bubble. Oh. And the ball squirts loose. It's going to go out of bounds. And
where do you mark that?
Well, that's a good question.
Yeah, they got to mark it up to the 24-yard line, looks like.
I think they're not going to allow the forward progress. Oh, there is a flag back up the field, so all of this may be for
Well, we got to see this play again. This we have to send this off to some national networks. That was a crazy play. All right, so no foul. So that should put the ball downfield on the 24-yard line for HBU. That's exactly what's happening. Let's watch this play again. Kadarius Baker with the pass. Watch this. Lazard looks like he gives up on it, but no, he turns around in the process of trying to make a defensive play, catches the ball, and then loses the ball out of bounds all the way down to the 24-yard line.
And
that's a break.
Still some discussion about where to spot the ball, and now the officials having another convention.
We're going to have to break out that Oakland Raiders Holy Roller rule book again.
Well, I think that may be what they're talking about.
Where to place the ball.
Where does it go? And now the referee's pointing back up the field. He's like, did you like it back up here better?
Yeah, maybe. I'm not sure if it – you can't just – if the ball gets knocked out of your hands like that, they just don't place it, you know, wherever it ends up going out of bounds. Players will be doing that all the time.
Right. Say this about the A&M Commerce defense. They are pretty good at coming up from behind and just punching that ball out. We've seen it 3 times here.
And I think that's where maybe the inexperience for HBU kind of shows when they're not as aware when they have the football of their surroundings and who's all around. You've got to tuck that ball away because there's someone trying to take it away from you at all times.
1st and 10 at the 42, handed off to Larry Day. Tries to get to the edge, turns it back inside. Not much there, but he does get down to the 40-yard line. A 2-yard carry. 2nd down and 8.
Yeah, this handoff here today. The blockers got out in front. Lazard doing a pretty nice job there, but play was kind of strung out a little bit too long, and that gave the Lions way too much time to get over there and make the play. And they've got a swarming defense. They usually, you notice they don't usually have just one man at the ball. They usually got 2 or 3 guys.
Under 2 minutes to go now here in the 3rd quarter. Huskies trying to keep the drive alive. Get on the scoreboard again. Play fake today. Pressure straight up the middle. Flushes Baker out of the pocket. He's on the run. Going to have to tuck it under. He gets to the sideline. Get something positive out of it, about a 2-yard gain and a little bit of extracurriculars over there on the Lions sideline. As
it looks like on 4th and 5 here, HBU is going to go for it.
Traven Johnson mixing it up a little bit in front of his own bench over there with a, well, I guess that looked like Baker who was run out of bounds. 3rd down now, 6 yards to go. Need to get to the 32-yard line. Ball's at the 38. Pull it out of the belly of Bell. Swing a pass out to Lewis. Get a couple of yards on it, but it's going to bring up 4th down at the 35-yard line. Gain of 3 on the play.
Yeah, Kadarius Baker took this snap, but I would have liked to have seen him get that ball out there just a little bit faster. But nonetheless, by the time he gets to his receiver, there was 2 Lions right on him in no time.
4th and 3. Got to keep the drive alive here. Clock rolls down under 40 seconds to go.
And I think what you're counting on a play like that is that even though you're throwing the ball short of the first down marker, you're still expecting him to try to make a play after the catch.
White clock got all the way down to 3 seconds, and so a little bit of confusion and pass tipped away on fourth down, and the ball will go over on downs to A&M Commerce with 21 seconds to go in the third quarter.
Yeah, let's see what happened. It almost looked like a bit of a false start there on top of that, but the ball was tipped and knocked away. That might have been a false start, might have been just what the doctor ordered after the way that play started.
Corey Childs, another Californian out of Bakersfield, got a hand on that ball for A&M Commerce.
And we've talked about this before too, Lonnie. A lot of times you'll have an assistant coach who's, you know, from out in California and has a nice setup of recruiting.
Right.
Some players out there that he may be from that area, and that seems to be the situation here for Texas A&M Commerce.
I want to be the one that recruits Hawaii. I'll just go on record there.
Well, and you'll get a chance to go out there pretty soon again, right?
I'm ready to go right now, Coach. That's going to be the last play of the third quarter, a loss of a yard on the first down carry. And it brings us to the end of three quarters of play, 48-21. Each team scores a touchdown in the third quarter. We head to the fourth. You're watching HBU Huskies football, presented by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation on the Legacy Sports Network.
I got no worries, got no woes.
Life is about making good choices. So when it comes to choosing the best emergency medical care, choose Neighbors Emergency Center. You could choose to see a board-certified physician at Neighbors Emergency Center right away. Or you could choose to wait. You could choose to receive top-quality imaging and laboratory services, or you could choose to wait. You could choose to enjoy our comfortable private treatment rooms, or you could choose to wait. You could choose to receive expert medical treatment while being treated like one of the family, or you could choose to wait. You could choose to get back to your life, or you get the picture. So if you have a medical emergency any time, day or night, the choice is clear. With Neighbors Emergency Center. Care that counts. Experience that matters.
Final football game of the season for your HBU Huskies. And they're down by 27 points and on defense to start the quarter. And here's a pass on the first play of the fourth quarter, and it's complete to Vernon Johnson from Harrison Stewart. That's been an effective combination here this afternoon and early evening for A&M Commerce.
Yeah, they've been kind of picking on Ari Hinton over there on the side, and that play's been there for him a couple of times, like you mentioned, and seems like they've just got the step. But, hey, give credit where credit is due. Harrison Stewart is putting the ball in the money.
He dropped it in there in stride for Johnson. Here's a handoff to Garrett on first down, and he is piled up at the line of scrimmage. No gain. They will give him the 32-yard line, it looks like.
Yeah, the Lions have bent at times here, but in the second half, they played pretty well defensively, like to try to keep Texas A&M Commerce out of the end zone here. I've got it at 7-7 here in the second half.
Stewart has time, wants to throw down the field, has a receiver caught, touchdown.
Check that, 14-7. Yeah. That's a good play right there, too, by the receiver. Once again, completely covered, but then it just comes down to who wants the ball more. Right there, it looked like Stacy Howard wanted it just a bit more. You got to know where you are on the field defensively as in the secondary. Where's the ball? You've got to just do a better job of knowing that when you put your arm up, you're going to knock the ball away. And unfortunately for HBU, by the time Ari Hinton got the hand up, he just kind of mistimed it.
You said they were picking on him. And
yeah, they
that
are.
That drive, they picked on him big time a couple of times. There's the extra point. It is good. So now 55.
Well, it's what Texas A&M Commerce does. They like to throw the football. This this isn't like they're running up the score. It's just what they do. But I think the Lions, you can see it. It's a different attitude at Texas A&M Commerce. And you know, as you mentioned before, they used to be East Texas State. Commerce just kind of close to the Oklahoma border up there in North Texas, around the Dallas-Fort Worth area, if you will. Kind of northeast.
Well, they are going to pick up, it looks like anyway, and I guess you should never count your chickens before they hatch, but they look like they're on their way to their seventh win of the season. And off a 1-9 year last year, that's an impressive turnaround for this first-year staff.
Yeah, they've impressed me. I wasn't for sure what we were going to see tonight, and I had last year they had the 1-9 record, plus they were without the quarterback who's been the most effective for them throughout the year, in Tyrick Rollison, but Rollison's out with a broken leg, so you weren't sure what you were going to get tonight. But I tell you what, I've been impressed with Harrison Stewart. Stays in the pocket well. When he runs, he's like a bulldozer. When he passes, he's been very efficient. He has put the ball like on a dime, I mean, throughout the game. And to think he's their backup for the most part, he may have earned himself a starting role. He is only a junior, 6'5", 245 pounds out of where else? California. Stacy Howard, one of his favorite targets, also out of Fontana, California.
Here's the kickoff. It's going to come down to Ethan Fry, who's back to receive it at the 3-yard line. Carries it straight up the field across the 20 out to the 26-yard line. So a good, solid return by Ethan Fry.
So we'll see if there's any roster changes, any of the newer players coming out. This is going to be Baker again at quarterback. Still see Bibbins and Darian Lazard, Craig Bell, B.J. Kelly out there.
Those look like the starters are all still out there on first and 10 at the 26-yard line. 13:48 to go in this ball game. Here's a swing pass out to Bibbins. Makes a catch, turns it up the field. Bumped out of bounds. He stayed on his feet. Big Ken was trying to sell a few extra yards there, but he's going to pick up 7 out to the 33-yard line.
Yeah, Bibbins kind of hurt his ribs in a game early this year. It was actually the pectoral muscle after the Incarnate Word game. But kind of played through some pain last week, really didn't play too much, and now a couple passes to him here tonight.
Go to him again, and he gets a first down on that carry. Same play, and good results again. Lost his footing right there at the end, and he's dropped at the 30. Well, they're going to spot it right at the 40-yard line. First and 10, the Huskies move the chains, keep the drive alive. Send the formation to the short side, and it's going to be a handoff to Craig Bell. He's going to be wrapped up in the backfield, maybe gets his motion forward back to the line of scrimmage. They'll mark it just shy of the 40-yard line, second and 10 to come.
I was kind of watching Chris Hill in the end of that play. He was still in kind of a shoving match with one of the defenders for Texas A&M Commerce.
Hand off to Bell again. Runs it to the right side. A little stretch play. Gets to the tackle box and down to about the 42-yard line.
And when I say shoving match, I don't mean in a negative way. Just continuing with his block even after the whistle had blown, just making sure that his man knew that he had him beat.
Well, and if you're an HBU coach right now, you want to see that. These old linemen you're talking about, you can never have enough. And there's Baker who bobbled the snap and then got the pressure and just had to duck under it and hit the turf back at the 31-yard line.
Yeah, tough break right there. Third down, I'd like to kind of see what they could do. And I don't know if Baker, well, yeah, the snap was just too low. So many little moving parts in a football game, and you overlook some of the most basic things, the center to quarterback exchange. And I tell you, it'll ruin a play quick when it's not good.
So Duncan on to kick the ball away again. Line drive kick is going to come down to Fields. He bobbles it. The ball is on the turf, and the Huskies finally get a break. except that there's a yellow marker on the ground.
You got to be kidding me.
That's got to be on the receiving team, right?
I'm happy to see that HBU didn't try to pick it up and run with it. We learned our mistake on that against Incarnate Word. But a pretty good little punt right here by David Duncan. And then look at this. It's just falling on it. That's what you want to do in that situation. That's Najee Bassoon. Caught up with Najee Bassoon after the right before the season started. Blocking the back. Okay, there we go. We'll keep the ball. And they'll tack that on.
Well, now our officiating crew, those guys, with all due respect, have had a rough afternoon. They just signaled first down for A&M Commerce, and there's no way that it can be a first down if you recovered the fumble, and now that's what they will signal. You'd much rather have the football, general rule of football, you'd much rather have it in your possession than give the guys a 10-yard penalty.
Yeah, absolutely.
Timeout on the field, and so we've got a little bit of time before the Huskies will send the offense back out there.
So impressions here, we've got basically 11:37 to play in the fourth quarter. What do you want to see here in the fourth and final quarter? You want to see hard, I know that. You want to see a team that's not going to quit. I mean, forget the scoreboard. I mean, I know it's 55-21, but right now you're trying to win the second half. And, you know, they went into the second half trailing 41-14, and now it's 48-21. So it's been fairly even here in the second half. We're now 55-21, check that. But a chance to get this game tied up, maybe go for two? Come on.
And, you know, it's interesting that you mentioned that. I remember specifically now as we look back now on this first season, back in August when we first visited with Vic Shealy, one of the things he made a point to tell us was that they were going to coach their players to go out and try and win every play. And so if that's the goal right now. You try to make something positive happen every time you've got the football and every time you touch it. And that's really what the goal is for the last 11 minutes and 37 seconds of football in this season.
There's the play that's worked.
This time Lazard gets a little pressure as they stayed home and read it. Well, you had to figure that sooner or later they would not bite on that sweep play.
Yeah.
Keep somebody home to watch the reverse.
If Lazard would have taken a peek downfield right about here, he would have seen it was wide open downfield to throw it. But, of course, that's easy to say when you got five guys chasing you. It's different.
Loss of eight on the play back to the 42-yard line. Second down and 18 to go from that spot. Need to get to the 24. Baker wants to throw, has Lazard, makes a catch, turns it back inside, and he's got somebody grabbing a face mask. The official, I think, saw that. He got down to about the 30-yard line before he's wrapped up. Watch it again here when we get a second.
It was a late flag, so it's got to be some sort of
watch the face mask go all the way around.
Yeah,
there
right
it is, right there.
Yeah, that's when the flag came in. And it was thrown right in that general area, too.
Should add 15 yards to the end of this reception. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness.
Did they not see it? I mean, quick, get them the tape. Let's show it to them. How's that not a face mask? I mean, Lazard almost has his head ripped off. Must have somehow thought that he kind of went across the top of the helmet. And maybe Lazard was I'm not going to try to justify it.
Let's move on. Next, here's Kadarius Baker wants to throw. The pass is deflected and knocked away, incomplete. Yeah, Jeff, there's no point in us trying to figure that one out because I thought it was pretty obvious.
Even if you don't grab the face mask, if you grab that ear hole and pull it around, it's still considered a face mask penalty.
Right.
I mean, the whole idea is you don't want to break somebody's neck, you know.
Exactly. Fourth down now for the Huskies following the incompletion. The ball is at the 29-yard line. Need to get 5 yards to keep the drive alive. Play fake, want to throw. Baker has a receiver, and he's hit right at the moment of
seriously
contact. Quadre Wilson, the intended receiver, and wow.
Well, we'll take a look at this again. I don't think there was any question there was pass interference here. The little fake handoff up the middle. Baker with a good pass here, and yeah, it's one of those timing things. I mean, you got two players arriving at the exact same time, and the ball is in between them. And it just in this particular case, the officiating crew going with no foul this time. But Tyron Watts there on the hit. It's a good hit by him. And he'll probably tell you, well, hey, it was perfect timing. What do you want from me?
Yeah.
I made a play.
Ball goes over to A&M Commerce. Derek Davis is checked in at quarterback again. He throws a little forward shovel pitch to running back. It's like Pablo Vasquez. Is that? No, 32, not 22. Excuse me, Kalen Winkler.
Derek Davis, you might remember him. He was from Arlington Bowie High School. 5'10", 220-pound senior. Bowie's had a lot of good skill players through the years. They were one of the projected favorites this year, but ran into some trouble when they had some injuries.
Spread it out, and Davis wants to throw. Has a receiver. It's complete, and that again is Kalen Winkler lined up in the slot that time. Makes the catch and gets a first down out to the 44-yard line. So A&M Commerce not easing up. No foot off the gas pedal here for these guys.
Yeah, they like to pass the ball. And in a lot of cases, I mean, I went to the University of Houston. I remember the feeling was like the shovel pass was a running play. The screen was a running play. The short pass across the, you know, to the running backs was a running play because they pass so often. And that's just what they do. That's what their offense is set to do.
Davis launches one down the field. Wow. Showed some arm strength there, but nobody in the vicinity. It goes incomplete.
That was one of those, hey, NFL scouts, you watching? Here's how far I can throw it. I'm a senior.
Stacy Howard was flying down the sideline, but even with his speed, he wasn't going to catch up to that thing.
He's kind of built a little bit like Kadarius Baker, maybe a little more size on Derek Davis, 5'10", 220.
Left-hander, and he flings it out in the flat. This time he finds Stacy Howard. It's complete. Gets a couple of yards.
In case you're wondering, Kadarius Baker's 5'10", 195. So about, you know, same height, sort of the same stocky build.
Pass from Davis to Howard is complete.
And as the game continues to change and you're seeing more and more quarterbacks that like to run the ball, they're becoming more and more like running backs, you know, not just someone who can pass the ball back there, but someone who can take off and run. And they're, you know, they're a bigger part, usually bigger players now. I mean, look at their starting quarterback, Harrison Stewart.
Yeah.
Big, 6'5", 220, 245, actually.
Blitz up the middle from Garrett Dolan, sets up a middle screen, and is Howard again, makes the catch. And just runs right up the hash marks and down to the 31-yard line. And they'll reset the chains and restart the clock, and we'll roll under 8 minutes to go.
Yeah, good call right there. Stacy Howard open downfield. Little screen pass. Start seeing those tackles about 20 yards down the field. Look out. How is that not a legal man downfield? Seems like you can't be that far downfield.
First and 10 at the 31. Three receivers out to the right side. Single receiver left. That's the short side of the field. Handed off. And out of the backfield, it's Richard Cooper, freshman out of Angleton. Angleton Wildcat out there. Cooper carries it down to about the 22-yard line.
So Texas A&M Commerce is going to move out to 7-3 this year, and looks like HBU is going to fall to 3-4. But you know, when you're talking with the coaches before the game and they're telling you, well, this is a team that we kind of compare to Sam Houston State and Abilene Christian, you know, you don't have to read into it too much to know that it's going to be a tough one to win. They need to play a near-perfect game, and they haven't played a perfect game. They were in it. I don't think there's any question they were right. in this game, you know, in the first half. But
Joshua Brown, the intended receiver that time, and went to the worst possible location, right into his hands, and he could not hang on. Watch this.
Third down and one. Yeah, he's looking downfield.
He turned that head. Just a split second.
I like their helmets also. That lion on one side and then just the number on the other side. You're seeing more and more schools go to that look. But the HBU look, that's a good-looking uniform, no question about it.
Third down, a yard to go. Davis wants to throw on third down, heads to the corner of the end zone and incomplete. That time the intended receiver was Lance Evans as they're working in some of their second and third string players on offense now. Went off his fingertips as well. That was another pretty good throw by Derek Davis.
So the basketball team coming off a pretty competitive game against Texas Tech, and get the Longhorns coming up here pretty soon in Austin.
Longhorns,
it's good schedule.
A week from Monday, the basketball team. Hopefully those guys have made it back into town by now.
Yeah.
But they have a game Monday night here at home, the home opener against Crowley's Ridge College. And then, as you mentioned, take on the Longhorns. Davis on fourth down on a keeper, just option read right up the middle, and he gets the first down, and that'll keep the drive alive. But against Texas Tech, the men's basketball team just ran into a team with a lot of size in the middle, and they've got a new head coach, Tubby Smith, of course. Has been at Kentucky, has been at Minnesota, and he has a proven track record and is a good man. We'll probably have that Texas Tech program being very competitive this year in the Big 12 Conference.
Well, they've got a great facility over there at United Airlines Stadium. That's nice out there, isn't it?
Yeah, it really is. In the middle of the High Plains. First and 10, handoff up the middle. Cooper on the carry. He plows his way forward, gets a couple of yards down to about the 15-yard line. It'll be a 3-yard gain, second and 7.
And it's not just the HBU men's basketball team. The women's basketball team should be very competitive this year.
And they are, for those who don't know, are moving into the Southland Conference this year. So moving from the Great West into the Southland Conference, of course, you pick up a lot of extra conference opponents and then a lot of extra conference games. But now you've got that added bonus of playing at the end of this regular season for an automatic bid to the tournament. The handoff, and it's Cooper again. He'll carry it up the middle. Check it. That's 28. Vincent Moore, a 5'11 junior out of Louisville, Kentucky. Third down coming up.
You know, I'm just kind of thinking with kind of a shortened season, if you will, 7 games. I kind of wonder if maybe some of these HBU players might actually even think about playing some other sports. I mean, there could be an opportunity. I mean, they've got some great athletes.
Yeah.
Let's see old Bibbins come out and try out for basketball.
Size, yeah.
Could you dunk it?
Yeah.
I'm sure he can.
Derek Davis got the snap off, but right as he did, a whistle from the far sideline, and it's a false start.
We know you don't really see that too often at the collegiate level, but obviously they will be in an off-season workout program, and as they continue to grow and become sophomores and some of the guys juniors and those junior college transfers become seniors, you know, it'll be anxious time to see how, you know, the improvement going from year one to year two. And that and everyone always says that's when you see big improvements from year one to year two.
Pressure comes from the edge, but Davis slips through and carries it forward up the middle of the field and gets down to about the 12-yard line. It's going to bring up second down or take a fourth down. Fourth and 4. Clock rolls under 4 minutes to go in this one. Winding down to the end of this game, end of the season. But as we said earlier, no matter the outcome of this one, it's been a good inaugural campaign for the Huskies. There's a pass overthrown. Jahalen Norris on the coverage, and the intended receiver that time was Darby Smith, a 5'10 freshman from Ennis, Texas. And the ball will go over on downs to the Huskies as Commerce fails to convert on the fourth down attempt. So with 3.5 minutes to go, HBU will get another look at the football here on offense, and we're going to see Baker and company right back out there. Jackie Robinson will come out at running back, so he'll join him in the backfield along with Tanner Peavy. Davis Iheanacho is checked in down to the bottom of your screen, out wide to the left side of the offensive formation. Hand it off to Tanner Peavy on first down, and he'll get out across the 15 to about the 16, 17-yard line. Give him about 5 yards on the carry.
Well, likely the final drive of the season, and maybe a chance here to kind of show some extra confidence in not only Kadarius Baker, but trying to see if they can't finish off the drive with a touchdown. And then we're going to go for two and win the second half.
Hand off up the middle again. This time I believe it was, no, I was starting to say Jackie Robinson, but C29 get up off the pile. So that's Tanner Peavy on the carry, and still got a A&M Commerce player down on the turf.
Timeout on the field.
2:43 to go.
Yeah, and Texas A&M Commerce will actually finish off with Eastern New Mexico. That is a conference game next Saturday at 2 o'clock. It'll be kind of interesting to see how they finish. If they, I tell you, if they finish 8-3, what a turnaround over there from 1-9 to 8-3. As for HBU, going to fall to 3-4 after this one, but I think they know where their strengths are. I think they know where they need to recruit and try to pick up some depth. And as these players get older and mature, it'll be anxious to see where this program is at next year.
Well, and talking to Coach Sheely earlier in the week, the coaches are going to be out on the recruiting trail as early as Monday morning.
I'm sure.
You know, they're going to be out looking to restock the pond here for next fishing season.
Well, and you've got the high school football playoffs starting, so you'll kind of see players up against stronger competition, so maybe get a better read on how good they are. A lot of times you get players, they'll spend 7 or 8 weeks against a poor district or something, and you're just not real sure how good they are. You get them into some playoff competition, and you get a better read.
Third down now for the Huskies. Swing and pass out to Davis. Iheanacho makes the catch out across the 20 to the 23, 24-yard line. And they'll actually give him out to the 25, enough for a first down, move the chains.
Yeah, Iheanacho here with a great grab, looking downfield, able to pick up some decent yardage.
.215 and counting. Baker to throw, looks for a receiver. And Zach Lazarine had gotten around his defender, but I think good defensive play in that it forced Zach to take a little wider path to the football than he wanted to, and he could not catch up to the pass.
I tell you, Zach Lazarine and Ethan Fry, they've got good speed. I'd like to see those two take off on the sideline side by side.
See him down there at the left-hand side of your screen. Lazarine, number 11, split out wide to the right side. Fry in the slot, handoff to Jackie Robinson instead. Had a touchdown run last week, a big 45-yard run for a score. Wrapped up after a couple-yard gain here.
Yeah, he's out of Pearland, Texas. Played at Pearland High School, Oilers.
Jack, it was a backup running back on that 2010 state championship team for Tony Heath and company. Third down here, 3rd and 8. Baker to throw, has Ethan Fry at midfield, makes the catch. Right over the E and strike. And he will be dropped at the 48-yard line, and that's a first down for the Huskies.
Yeah, nice route right there by Ethan Fry, the 6'1", 180-pound freshman from Cedar Park. Grabs this ball around midfield and picks up some extra yardage there after the catch. He's got that blistering speed. That's why that end-around play with him works out well. That's why he also returns punts. He's one of those players that they like to get his speed on the field whenever possible.
5 yards stepped off against HBU. Pre-snap penalty there. Backs it up to the 47-yard line. Well, Jeff, it's been a lot of fun this short season, and look forward to next season. And that should be as fun or maybe more.
Yeah, it's going to be great playing on campus, seating all set up.
Baker
nice.
Downfield and overthrows Iheanacho. Yeah, the construction on the stands around the facility should begin in the fall. Yeah, mm-hmm. There you. We don't have it on camera for you right now, but we have some renderings of what hopefully the stadium will look like. It's going to be a nice facility.
Yeah, Dunham Field, beautiful turf, HBU across the 50-yard line, and one set of stands.
Hand off to Tanner Peavy, wrapped up in the backfield, dropped for a loss. It's going to be third down after about a 3-yard loss back to the 44. It'll be third and 18.
24 seconds and counting. We'll see if they even run into the play right here.
And third down 17. Doesn't look like they will. Well, maybe they are going to step up to the line for one final snap as the clock rolls under 10 seconds to go in the season for the HBU Huskies. And the last play will be Baker winding up the throw across the middle. Ethan Fry makes the catch. So a nice positive play ends this ball game. But the Huskies come up on the short end of the score. 55-21 is the final.
So Ethan Fry picks up a couple of big receptions on this last drive. And I'm sure he's going to feel pretty good. He gets up, tosses the ball to the official real quick, says, come on, guys, let's go. Sorry, Ethan, game's over. Got to like the enthusiasm, though.
To just have a little bit more time.
Yeah. We didn't lose. We just ran out of time.
Hey, we'll take a break and come back and put a wrap on this one. You've been watching HBU Huskies football presented by the Baptist Church Loan Corporation on the Legacy Sports Network.
If I get pneumonia,
break my arm.
Need to know if my pain is something more.
I know I can trust Neighbors Emergency Center to save me.
They save my time.
They'll save me from missing the championship.
They'll save me from missing my meeting.
They'll save me from missing the chance to walk her down the aisle someday.
They save me.
He saves me.
You save me.
Neighbors Emergency Center saves lives.
Neighbors Emergency Center. Care that counts. Experience that matters.
I think I have the window seat.
You better double check that, my friend. Don't think we don't know who you are.
Yeah, I'm Aaron Rodgers.
No, that's not it. You're that State Farm discount double check guy.
Discount double check.
Thanks to the hundreds you saved us, we could upgrade the grill class.
Grill class?
Your tongs are in your seat back.
Save with the discount double check today.
Discount double check.
Get to a better state, State Farm.
It's time to go back in time. Share in the merriment of hundreds of live performances, the taste of over 1,000 foods, and the fun of dozens of games and rides. And be sure to enjoy special savings opening weekend, October 12th and 13th. Brought to you by DeMontron Coca-Cola. Huzzah!
McDonald's Dollar Menu just keeps getting better.
Yeah.
Introducing an all-new mouth-watering grilled onion cheddar burger.
Top
of melty white cheddar and caramelized onions.
Look great.
Plus all your tasty favorites for just $1 each.
Power, step to your right.
Keep going.
Every day.
Keep going.
Always,
keep going.
It's your head.
Your head needs to cover that light.
Dollar menu.
There
right
you
there.
Go. Look.
No more.
Yes. There
tell
you
Lonnie
go.
Scoot his ass to the right.
Lonnie, scoot your ass to the right.
See, y'all need to scoot to the right, both of y'all.
Both y'all need to go to the right. There you go.
And
right
those
there.
Who look only to the
perfect.
Past
perfect.
Are
right, after
ready
this we'll come back, right?
For their future.
Final stats you want.
To wait. To wait.
You want us to wait till you get the final stats? Yeah. Yeah, wait. Copy that.
Hey, what happened was HBU ran about 35 yards, and the other guys ran about 6,000.
Hey, Matt said HBU ran for about 35.
Have you recently lost
and,
your job or been denied medical care?
Bombers ran
has
for
your doctor told
6,
you their panel
yards
is full and they cannot take you?
No, they passed the
at
ball.
Pasadena
they didn't
Health
the ball.
Center,
the
we
ball
make health care affordable and provide access to reliable, quality health care in a caring atmosphere. We offer services in family medicine, dental, OBGYN, pediatrics, x-ray, lab, and pharmacy. We accept Medicare, Medicaid, private insurance, and offer discounted fees for self-pay patients. Pasadena Health Center, where caring is what we do best.
When you have a medical emergency, think Physicians ER.
You
will be seen by a
board-certified
doctor in less than 10 minutes. With immediate results on labs, x-rays, and CAT scans. For emergency care greater than urgent care, think Physicians ER. Accidents happen anytime, any place. When you need to be seen fast, visit Physicians ER. Visit PhysiciansER.com for a location nearest you.
Go.
Back here at Straight Jesuit Crusader Stadium, the 2013 home for the HBU Huskies football team for the final time on the 2013 season, a 55-21 defeat for the HBU Huskies on homecoming weekend. Jeff, a lot of good things happened this season and this weekend. Unfortunately, the scoreboard's not going to show what the Huskies wanted to, but a lot to build on going into next year.
Well, I think they would have taken knowing that they would finish 3-4 on the season when you look back before it started. They've won the games they were supposed to win, lost the games they were supposed to lose. At times, they showed glimpses of greatness, even against some of the better teams. But at times, you could see the fact that they had so many freshmen, or the fact that they were inexperienced at some positions, and that would kind of, in the end, be what, you know, would produce some of the losses. But I think overall, you look at what they've done this year, and you got to feel pretty good about the future of HBU football.
I think you make an important point. The one of the main takeaways from this season is that this was an extremely young team, and they can do nothing but get older next year.
Yeah, I mean, almost all freshmen out there. Here we are on homecoming. There's really no seniors to go out there and do senior day. But then, you look across the field. I'll tell you what's kind of encouraging here. You look at the fact that Texas A&M Commerce was 1-9 last year, and this year they got a chance to finish, looks like 7-3, maybe 8-3, get some postseason play. In other words, things can happen real quickly in the college ranks. You can turn things around fast. No reason to think that next year when the team HBU is playing on campus, they join the Southland Conference, kind of get in a role early on in the year, playing maybe a non-district or non-conference schedule. That's something that they could work with, and then once they get into conference play, kind of take your chances and see what happens.
Not to mention the fact one of the things that the coaches have consistently focused on is the fact that the recruiting base that they've got here in the Houston metropolitan area is something that they think is deep enough to provide them a lot of talent for future years.
Well, and Coach Vic Sheely and the guys will go out and start recruiting next week. They'll get a chance to see a lot of talent all over the state. And I don't think they're just going to stay in the Houston area. I don't think there's any question.
No,
you see what
sure.
On the other side, Texas A&M Commerce was out in California, obviously a lot recruiting out there. And some real positive things to build on. I mean, you think about what B.J. Kelly, Darian Lazard, Kadarius Baker, some of these guys, what they've been able to do for the offense and on defense, Cody Moncur, some of the players that have kind of been key. They've really showed a lot of leadership out there. They've been, where you need them in certain plays. And they'll be the first to tell you, too. They know they can grow and be more experienced and learn that not only the playbook, but where they're supposed to be on the field at all times, you know.
So they've got something to look forward to for the 2014 season, but they wind up this season with a 55-21 loss at the hands of Texas A&M Commerce. We're going to say so long for the night, so long for the season. For Jeff Power, I'm Lonnie King. Glad you've been a part of it all season long. Thanks for being along for the ride. special thanks to our executive producer at the Legacy Sports Network, Matt Broussard, and his entire crew that helped us bring this one to you and all the home games this season. For all of them, and for Jeff Power, I'm Lonnie King. So long, everybody. Dogs up.